This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome back to The Glowing Dial. We're with you once again here for, the 27th time in this current run of the show, which started in April of last year. And we're glad to be back with you. There was a couple of hiatuses there along the way, weren't there? Both of them due to health problems on my side. But we've gotten through those and we're well into another run here on the Glowing Dial. Big John Matthews, your Worm Rotund host, sitting here in front of the mic and sitting over there in front of that mic, filling in once again for Steve Archive Urbanic. I almost didn't say that properly. Is Mr. Greg Barker. Hello, sir.
Hi.
Hi.
Boy,
you come on louder than me for some reason there.
Oh, sorry. Hi.
Well, you have more timber in your voice.
Timber.
Which means Greg was raised from a family of lumberjacks.
Yep. I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay.
Ringo in the background there giving us our rim shots. Thank you very much, sir. Tip your sticks to the audience if you... There we go. Very nice.
Not
very
in public.
Nice. He can tip his sticks in public, you know. It's not like tipping something else in public, which is this a family show, so we won't do that.
Meow.
Meow, yeah. Folks, we are celebrating a holiday this time around. Columbus Day is October the 12th, so we wish you a very happy Columbus Day and hope you discover something interesting
Bidiboom.
That has meaning in your life. We are also presenting a salute to Radio Westerns.
Yeehaw!
Cue the gunshots. Ringo, can you give us a few gunshots? No, that kind of wasn't a gunshot there.
It was a shot.
It was a rim shot. It wasn't a gunshot.
It was the shot heard round the studio.
Yes, and you scared the Candrews sisters with that one, Ringo. He's grinning. The sisters are kind of giving him the eye right now. The three sisters.
With one eye.
The three sisters. If you were a R&B act, that's probably what you would be called. Anyway. That's the show, and we've got lined up for you. We're going to be hearing from the Lone Ranger, Gunsmoke, Hopalong Cassidy, and the Cisco Kid, or if you prefer, the Cisco Kid. If you're a poncho and announcing the show, that's probably the way you would do it. We're going to get started with all of that and more, folks, right after these all-important messages. Perhaps the funniest series ever on radio is now available in a 14-CD limited edition package. That's all 273 episodes, plus bonus material. Yes, available at last. The complete story of Chicken Man. This is the ultimate collector's package, mastered from the original master tapes by Dick Orkin, Chicken Man's creator and voice. Aside from every Chicken Man episode ever made, this package includes interviews with key players, behind-the-scenes stories, and an official colors photo, personally autographed by Chicken Man himself. And each limited edition package is individually numbered. A very naughty criminal mastermind, now a reformed swell guy, says of our hero,
"The most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known."
An anonymous admirer says,
"He's poultry in motion."
By now, you're probably asking yourself, how the heck can I get one of these neato packages? Well, simply hop online and go to glowingdial.com. Scroll down and you'll see the magnificent No Expense Spared advertisement and ordering link. Remember, this is a limited edition numbered package, so you better hurry up and order. If you don't, you might miss out. And then all I can say is, well... We're back with you, folks. Time for our first Western. That's going to be an episode of The Lone Ranger. This is a story that was asked to be repeated several times throughout the run of the series. It's called The Origin of the Lone Ranger. It's from Wednesday, June 30th, 1948. Originally over WXYZ Radio right here in Detroit. That's where it originated. And it was also heard on the ABC radio network. And it is starring Brace Beamer, John Todd, Jack McCarthy, Paul Sutton, and Jack Petruzzi, and also Paul Hughes. And I believe this one was announced by Fred Foy, although we have a source that says Fred Foy did not start as the announcer until the July 2nd, 1948 broadcast. But this sounds a lot like Fred, although I cannot totally confirm that. So Fred, of course, is the gentleman that was nice enough to do an introduction to our show and lend us a little bit more class. And he didn't charge us anything for it. I met Fred at a nostalgia convention where I had a couple of lines with him in a recreation of a Sergeant Preston of the Yukon episode. I had all two or three lines. But I'm standing next to Fred Foy, so that was kind of cool. And that's where he agreed to record the opening for our show. So thank you, Fred. You live on in our memories, sir. Greg is standing by now with a good deal of information on the Lone Ranger.
Over to me. All right. The Lone Ranger first appeared in 1933 in a radio show conceived by, as John mentioned, WXYZ Radio in Detroit, by owner George Trendle and show's writer Fran Stryker. The character was originally believed to be inspired by Texas Ranger Captain John Hughes, who hunted down the gang who killed Texas Ranger Captain Frank Jones in an ambush. Zane Grey dedicated his book The Lone Star Ranger in Hughes' honor. The radio series proved to be a hit and spawned a series of books largely written by Stryker. An equally popular television show that ran from 1949 to 1957, comic books, and movies. The title character was played on radio by George Seton, Earl Grazer, and most memorable, Brace Beamer. To television viewers, Clayton Moore was the Lone Ranger. Although during a contract dispute, Moore was replaced for a time by John Hart, who wore a different style of mask. On the radio, Tonto was played by John Todd and Roland Parker, among others. And in the television series by Jay Silverheels, who was, in fact, a Mohawk from the Six Nations Indian Reserve in Ontario, Canada. The Lone Ranger is so named because the character is the only survivor of a group of six Texas Rangers, rather than because he worked alone. While details differ, the basic origin story is the same in most versions of the franchise. A posse of six members of the Texas Ranger Division pursuing a band of outlaws is betrayed by a civilian guide and ambushed in a canyon. Later, an Indian named Tonto stumbles upon the scene and discovers one ranger is barely alive and nurses him back to health. In some versions, Tonto recognizes the lone survivor as the man who saved his life when they were children. According to the television series, when Tonto left the Reed place with a horse given him by the boy Reed, he gave Reed a ring and the name Kemosabe, which he said means trusty scout. Among the Rangers killed was the survivor's older brother, Daniel Reed, who was a captain in the Texas Rangers and the leader of the ambushed gang. To conceal his identity and honor his fallen brother, Reed fashions a black domino mask from the material of his brother's vest, a vest upon which the Star of Justice had lain. To aid in the deception, Tonto digs a sixth grave and places at its head a cross bearing John's name so that Cavendish and his gang would believe that all of the Rangers had been killed. In many versions, Reed continues fighting for justice as the Lone Ranger even after the Cavendish gang is captured. The first episodes of The Lone Ranger premiered on radio January 30, 1933, on WXYZ Radio in Detroit. As previously mentioned, the show was an immediate success. Though it was aimed at children, adults made up at least half the listening audience. It became so popular, it was picked up by the Mutual Broadcasting System and on May 2, 1942, by NBC's Blue Network, which in time became ABC. The last new episode was broadcast September 3, 1954. Transcribed repeats of the 1952-53 episodes continued to be aired on ABC until June 24, 1955. Then selected repeats appeared on NBC's late afternoon weekday schedule from September 1955 to May 1956.
All right. Thank you, sir. There's a lot of information there in some of the backstory of the episode we're going to be hearing, which is called The Origin of the Lone Ranger. So nothing remains now for us to pull this episode, extract it from the ether of yesteryear. I like that. That's magical. Got to change it up a little bit. Just time to play this episode with folks or tune it in. And, you know, did you know we can play the McGee machine like a theremin?
Really?
No, actually, no.
Oh, that'd be cool.
That would be, actually. We'd have a theremin concert here. Yeah, you know what a theremin is out there, don't you, folks?
Really? Seriously? You don't know what a theremin is?
It's a musical instrument that was invented in the 1920s.
In fact, it was the first electronic musical instrument.
One of the first, yes. Mm-hmm. Leon Theremin, a Russian immigrant, was the guy that did it. And it had a weird... If you've heard a lot of sci-fi films, some Twilight Zones, that high-pitched... Day of the Earth Stood Still featured it.
Oh, yes.
And lots of soundtracks. The Lost Weekend with Ray Milland. Theremin featured prominently in that score when Ray was having his DTs and his need for alcohol. So anyway, check out Theremin and that do it on Wiki, and that's going to lead you to a whole bunch of other cool electronic instruments over the years. But now, Greg, if you would reach for the McGee machine,
here we go.
Yep, there we go.
And a little more.
All right, folks, there it is. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember the Lone Ranger. This is the origin of the Lone Ranger. From Wednesday, June 30th, 1948, originally over WXYZ Detroit and ABC.
A cloud of dust and a hearty hi-yo, Silver, the Lone Ranger.
Thank you.
With his faithful Indian companion, Tonto, the daring and resourceful masked rider of the plains led the fight for law and order in the early western United States. Nowhere in the pages of history can one find a greater champion of justice. Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear. From out of the past come the thundering hoofbeats of the great horse Silver. The Lone Ranger rides again.
Come on, Silver. Let's go, big fellow. Are you Silver? Away!
In response to hundreds of requests from interested listeners, this Lone Ranger program will retell the story of the origin of the Lone Ranger, how he met Tonto, how he got his name, and how the Lone Ranger found the great horse Silver. This is the story of a man who buried his identity to dedicate his life to the service of humanity and country. It is the story of an American heritage, the story of the Lone Ranger. Six men guided their horses along a canyon floor toward the hideout of the Cavendish gang, the strongest, most ruthless gang in all the West. The six were undismayed by the heavy odds against them. They were Texas Rangers.
Rein up, boys.
Whoa, easy, fella.
We'll wait here until a scout returns.
You think it was a good idea to send Collins on ahead?
It was Captain Reed's younger brother who asked the question.
Are you sure you can trust Collins?
We have no choice. We must trust him. We've got to know if Butch Cavendish has learned that we're heading for his hideout.
Well, you're the captain.
Forget that for a minute. I want to speak to your brother to brother. My wife and son are coming from the east. If something happens to me and you survive, well, I know you'll take care of Danny.
You know I will.
If I don't survive, I'm going to count on you to resign from the Rangers and work that silver mine we've staked out. Use my share to raise my son. Your nephew.
Here comes the scout, Captain.
What's the word, Collins?
Good news, Captain Reed. It's all clear. I scouted the rim on both sides of the canyon and found no sign of the Cavendish outfit.
All right, boys. Let's go get Cavendish. Get up there.
Get up. Order.
The guide named Collins remained behind as the Rangers moved in single file along the floor of the rock-strewn canyon. They didn't know that Collins had lied, that Butch Cavendish and his killers were waiting on the rim of the ravine.
Now listen, we'll hold our fire until they're right below. Men on the other side of the canyon will start shooting when we do. We'll have those Rangers trapped between
us.
Good
idea, right, boss.
You'll have to shoot straight. Be sure to get all six of those men. We can't get down to the floor of that canyon without going all the way back to the hideout. And it'll be dark in half an hour, so don't take chances. When a man goes down, keep on pouring lead into him till you're sure he's dead. Now get ready.
Come on, boys. All right, men, open fire.
Several hits were scored with the opening volley from the outlaw's gun, but none of the wounds were fatal. Six men swung from their saddles and spread out as they returned the fire from both sides of the canyon. They hugged the ground, taking advantage of the meager protection afforded by small rocks. Then one of the guns was silenced, but five returned the deadly fire from up above.
Double-crossed. If any of us get out of this, we have a score to settle with that scout Collins.
The captain and his brother fought side by side, while bullets from both sides of the canyon crashed into rocks close by.
Jackson's just been hit. You're hit.
It's all right. I can still fight.
But you're wounded. Dan, I'll get that one. The dirty killer. Dan, how badly are you hit? Dan.
How many left?
Three of us. I'm going. Then there'll be two. You remember? Promise. My boy. Little Dan.
As long as I live, I'll not forget that promise.
The outlaws on the rim grew bolder when they saw that there was but one gun firing from the canyon floor. Then that gun, too, went silent. Twilight deepened into darkness, relieved by the cold light of a full moon. And then another figure moved among the still bodies. It was an Indian clad in a jacket of fringed buckskin. He examined the men to whom heroic deeds had been a part of each day's work.
Him dead.
5 times the Indian found a man whose soul had gone to join the immortals. But when he came to the 6th, he found what Collins had failed to discover. He found a faint spark of life still burning. The Indian lifted this man tenderly in his strong arms and carried him away. The wounded man was taken to a nearby cave where the Indian bathed and dressed the wounds as best he could. Then he took a spade from one side of the cave and returned to the canyon where he worked steadily until the dead men had been buried. Returning to the cavern, he sat watching, listening periodically to the faint beat of a gallant heart through the remaining hours of the night. Daybreak found that heartbeat stronger. But by nightfall, a new enemy assailed the ranger. The wounds became infective and there was fever. The Indian called on all the lore he knew and went through 2 days and nights without rest in a valiant effort to combat the all-consuming fever that threatened to kill where outlaws' guns had failed. It was daybreak when the ranger opened his eyes, and for the first time, the Indian saw them, clear and calm.
You wake? Me glad.
Yes, but I... so weak.
But you wounded man.
I remember an ambush.
That right. Me find you in canyon. Carry you here.
This is a cave?
That right.
Why, it's daylight.
Oh, it's morning.
Then I must have been unconscious all night.
It 4 days since fighting canyon.
There's something familiar about you.
What? Many year ago, when you only boy, you find Indian boy in trouble. You save life, Indian boy.
Now I remember. Your name is Tonto.
That right.
Was you who found me, dressed my wound, saved my life.
Ah.
I remember what you called me years ago. You called me Kimosabe.
That right. Kimosabe. It means trusty scout.
Tonto, there were 6 of us in that canyon. The others... what about the other rangers?
Other rangers? All dead.
Dead?
Huh.
One of them was my brother.
Mm. You only one left? You, Lone Ranger.
The Lone Ranger. The only one who knows about that gang. I'm going to get every one of those crooks. I'm going to carry on that war. For every one of the men who died, 100 crooks are going to feel the weight of justice. God willing, I'll make every criminal in the new frontier regret the day you found a dying ranger and nursed him back to life. As soon as I'm strong enough to carry guns, I'll be the Lone Ranger.
Tonto was amazed at the sudden strength that seemed to surge through the wounded man. He seemed to be transformed by some strange alchemy into the composite of all 6 rangers. In his eyes, there was a light that must have burned in the eyes of knights in armor. A light that through the ages lifted the souls of strong men who fought for justice, for Christianity.
Tonto, those killers know me by sight. They know one of the rangers escaped. They'll look for him.
Them not know one escaped, Kimosabe. Tonto bury 5 men, make 6 mounds. Crooks think you die with others.
Then my identity shall be forever buried with my brother. My friends. Now on, my face must be concealed by a mask or disguise.
No. You stay quiet 5-6 days. Get strength back.
Tonto, while we go after the Cavendish gang, we've got to watch for a little boy and his mother who are coming from the east. We've got to go to a silver mine.
Silver mine?
Yes, a secret one. I know an old man I can trust. He used to be a ranger. You'll stay at the mine and work it just enough to supply the cash we'll need, so... Oh, so much to be done. So much.
Maybe better you rest now, Kemosabe. Rest a little while, then talk.
Yes, I'll rest a little while, then we'll make plans.
Several weeks had elapsed since the massacre in Bryant's Gap. The ranger whom Tonto had rescued had regained his strength and ridden with an old man into a remote section of the hills where a small shack concealed the entrance to a silver mine.
So this is the shack you and your brother built.
Yes, Jim. This is where you'll have to live and work.
I'm sure sorry to hear about the death of your brother. He was a fine man. Didn't he have a little boy?
Yes, Jim. Now that my brother's gone, half of this silver mine belongs to his son.
Where is the boy?
I don't know, but I've got to find him. I hope I can be as much to him as my brother was to me.
Yeah, you and the boy will be pretty well fixed with this silver mine.
All I want out of it is enough for my immediate needs. You may have the rest of my share.
Oh, no.
All right, Jim. You're entitled to it. You'll have to do all the work. And remember, you're never to reveal the fact that I have any connection with this silver mine. I have nothing to do with it. To all intents and purposes, it belongs to you.
I could refine a little ore right here in the shack.
That's what I want you to do, Jim. I'll come here when I need money or bullets.
Bullets?
Yes, I want some of the ore cast into silver bullets.
Thunderation, lead bullets are good enough to get revenge against the Cavendish gang.
I'll not use the bullets for revenge, Jim. I want them to be a symbol of justice by law. I want those who see them to be reminded that sooner or later every criminal will be defeated.
The best justice...
Yes, but... I made my plans carefully, Jim. I'm sure I'm right.
Well, when are you starting out?
As soon as Tonto arrives with strong horses...
The curtain falls on the first act of our Lone Ranger story. Before the next exciting scenes, please permit us to pause for just a few moments. Continue our story. During the next few days, the man who had become the Lone Ranger helped his old friend bring ore from the tunnel and refine it into purest silver, which was cast into bullets that studded a heavy gun belt. In the meantime, he made a mask to cover the upper portion of his face. Then Tonto returned with strong horses and bad news.
Indians and outlaw gang make raid on wagon train from east. All wagons burned and all people killed.
Tonto, my brother's wife and son were coming from the east on a wagon train. I wonder if it's the one that...
Me fine trunk all burned.
A trunk?
Ah. Copper plate on trunk. Me bring it here. Show you. Their name on plate.
Read. My brother's trunk. Tonto, was there... Does anyone know if there was a little boy in that caravan?
Me not know.
I wonder if we'll ever know.
I expect you'll be starting out tomorrow.
No, not tomorrow, Jim. We're starting out right now. We have a lot to do. Hit the saddle, Tonto.
Uh-huh.
I'll keep an eye on things here.
Keep a supply of silver bullets on hand.
They'll be ready.
We'll be back. Come on, Tonto. Steady. Easy, Tonto. Uh-huh. Goodbye, Jim.
Goodbye. Good luck to you.
Thanks. Get up there. Come on, cover.
Good luck, Lone Ranger.
Ranger quickly captured several members of the Cavendish gang. Others knew that they were hunted men. They scattered and fled in all directions. But the masked man maintained a relentless pursuit of one after another. The trails led through several states. Collins, the faithless scout, was run to earth in Laramie. His pal was caught in Julesburg, and another of the killers was turned over to the law in Cheyenne. Months had gone by since the masked man started on his mission. Butch Cavendish himself was the only member of the gang who remained at large. He knew that he was hunted. He knew that his masked nemesis could be stopped only by death. On one occasion, the Lone Ranger had come close, but Cavendish owned the faster horse. He got away, but his escape was only temporary. With Tonto at his side, the masked man pressed on till the trail was new and sharp.
We're close to Cavendish now, Kemosabe.
Yes, Tonto. He can't be far ahead.
Him outrun us last time. Maybe better we shoot on sight.
No, I want to take him alive.
Look out!
Hey, there, steady boy!
Over there, killer in ambush, him right way.
He shot my horse, Tonto. Get after him!
Get him up, feller!
Once more, the superior speed of the outlaw's horse carried Cavendish to safety. When Tonto returned from the futile chase, the masked man stood beside his dead horse.
A good horse, Tonto. Loyal, faithful, and brave. But my next horse must be faster. I wish that... Tonto, we've heard stories of a wild horse. A fiery white stallion.
Ah, him seen near valley. Over that way.
Yes, Cavendish went that way. We'll be on the lookout for the wild horse as well as a man.
Tonto's horse carried the Lone Ranger's saddle and supplies, while the masked man and the Indian continued along the outlaw's trail with dogged perseverance. In the meantime, a fiery white stallion, the king of Wild Horse Valley, had left the Green Hills to seek adventure in the outer world. He met a buffalo, a shaggy monster of tremendous size and strength, whose evil eyes burned with a lust for murder as he challenged the white one to battle. It was a fight of earth-shaking fury. The sun flashed from the sleek body of the white one as he dodged and sidestepped charge after charge, then reared high to strike at the infuriated adversary. He was nimble and courageous, but his strength began to wane as the battle went on. The buffalo charged again and again. The splendid muscles of the white one were slower in responding, then too slow. He was caught by the shaggy monster's charge. Wet crimson stained his pure white coat. Another charge. The white one saw it coming, and he couldn't dodge. He staggered and fell. The monster drew back. His head was lowered, and he pawed the ground in readiness for the charge that would drive the cruel horns deep into the white one's body, the death charge. And then two shots rang out. The buffalo shuddered from the impact of the masked man's silver bullets. For an instant, he stood motionless, then fell. Cruelly battered and bruised, the white stallion lay quietly. But his soft eyes watched every move as the Lone Ranger bathed his wounds and wiped the dust from his delicate nostrils with a damp cloth. For a long time, he rested, then scrambled to his feet.
Me get rope. Him run away.
No, wait, Tonto.
Let him go.
Let him go. I like that horse more than anything in the world, but he deserves his freedom. He fought for it.
Him stop.
Yes, he's turned. He's looking at us. See how white he is?
Ah, him silver white.
Silver. That would be a name for him.
Here, Silver!
Him plenty wild.
Tonto. Tonto, he's coming toward us.
Ah.
Silver. Silver, you beauty. Tonto, hand me a halter.
Huh?
If you could only know how badly we need him. Steady there. Steady, Silver.
Oh, him let you use halter.
The saddle, Tonto.
Oh, no horse like that take saddle.
There never was a horse like this.
As the mighty stallion felt the pressure of the saddle on his powerful back, he trembled as if from a chill. Every instinct told him he must flee at once to preserve his freedom. Yet he stood his ground, submitting to the things done by the man who had saved his life. It wasn't gratitude that kept him there. It was something stronger, some mysterious bond of friendship and understanding. He heard the man's low voice and liked it.
Silver. Silver, we're going to be partners. Yes, I'm going to mount, Silver. Don't be afraid. Steady now, fella. Easy. Steady, Silver. It's all right, big fella. Tonto, he's willing. Now I'm going after Cavendish.
Come on, Silver!
the white stallion had no bit to guide him. It was nothing but a halter, but he seemed to know just what his new friend desired. He was eager to please, eager to show his strength and speed. His flowing mane and tail streamed out like banners in the wind. No hoofs had ever beat the plains like those thundering hoofs of the great horse Silver. Presently, Cavendish came into view.
There he is! Come on, Silver!
The mighty stallion responded with a new burst of speed that quickly cut down the lead of the man ahead. Cavendish fired wild shots over his shoulder. Again and again he fired until his gun was empty. His horse was no match for the charging white one. Fear and panic filled the outlaw's face. He heard the hoofbeats ever nearer, and then the masked man shouts,
I want you, Cavendish!
Get away! Get away, you hear me? Let me be! Let me be! Get away, I tell you!
The two were side by side. The masked man leaned out, reached, then threw himself at Cavendish.
Come on, Cavendish, on your feet!
Don't hit me again. Don't kill me.
I'm not going to kill you. I'll let the law do that. The hangman's rope is waiting for you.
The masked man's mission was accomplished. He had captured the last member of the Cavendish gang, but there were other outlaws, other trails that beckoned the Lone Ranger Tonto and the White Horse Silver. The rest is history. The Lone Ranger turned the blinding light of justice on criminals in all communities, but he never forgot the promise made to his brother. A promise to try to find the boy, Dan Reed. He fought claim jumpers, rustlers, and smugglers. Side by side, he fought with builders of the West, the pioneers in covered wagons, the carriers of mail, the stage lines, and the pony riders. He became known throughout the West by his mask, the White Horse Silver, and a ringing cry,
Hail Silver!
His adventures took him to the high border country, where he fought and conquered men who sought to rob an old lady and her adopted grandson. It must have been fate that guided him there and took him to the side of the woman's deathbed, where he learned about the 14-year-old boy whom she had found as a baby, the only survivor of an Indian attack. She handed him a locket that had been about the baby's neck. The Lone Ranger found Dan Reed sitting on the steps of the little white house.
Do you mind if I sit beside you, Dan?
No, sir.
Thanks. Your grandmother was a wonderful woman.
She sure was.
Before she died, she told me all about you. How she had found you as a baby.
That's right. I wasn't a real grandson. I was just adopted. My right name is Dan Reed.
Yes, I know. I saw the pictures of your mother and father in this locket.
Dad was a ranger. A captain?
Yes, I was with him when he was killed. In fact, I promised him I'd try to find you.
You did?
Dan, how would you like to go with me?
You mean travel with you all the time?
Yes.
Oh, golly, I can't think of anyone I'd rather be with. But why are you doing this for me?
Because, Dan, your father was my brother. I'll tell you about him and what he left you. Your father was one of the men among whom uncommon valor was a common virtue. Those men have handed down a great heritage, which you and others like you must protect and preserve. It's the heritage of every American. The right to live as free people in a land where there is true equality of opportunity. But it is your duty to be eternally vigilant, prepared at all times to fight those who dare to challenge our way of life. And you must build. It is your duty to make of this a greater nation, to build homes and farms and villages, mills, factories and great cities. Property is the fruit of labor. That some should be rich shows that others may become rich, and hence is just encouragement to industry and enterprise. Abraham Lincoln said, let not him who is houseless pull down the house of another, but let him labor diligently and build one for himself, thus by example assuring that his own shall be safe from violence when built. You have for your own a great nation, together with the will, the heart, the courage to make it even greater. This is your heritage, Dan. This is the heritage of every American.
Mm-hmm. that is the message of the Lone Ranger. George W. Trendle production, directed by Charles D. Livingston. This story was written by Fran Stryker, and the part of the Lone Ranger is played by Brace Beamer.
This is Fred Foy. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
We're back with you, folks. I hope you enjoyed The Lone Ranger. That was the origin of The Lone Ranger from Wednesday, June 30th, 1948, over WXYZ in Detroit and as well as ABC radio.
I think the fact that, you know, the fact that the show originally in Detroit, you know, where we live.
Yes.
You know, is that's cool.
It did you sit on a pin there or something? Or you suddenly rose about 10 octaves there. Well, you know, the Green Hornet was also out of XYZ, so was Sergeant Preston of the Yukon.
Oh, did not know that.
The Hermit's Cave was out of WJR.
Don't know that one at all, actually.
It was kind of a horror show.
Oh, okay.
And it's one that, in talking to my dad in years past, it's one that he remembered listening to when he was younger.
Mm.
He called it The Mummers.
And I said, Mummers?
Well, what are The Mummers? Turns out The Mummers were the theatrical group. It was the name of the theatrical group here in Detroit.
Huh.
And they performed on The Hermit's Cave.
They mummed everything.
Which they mummered, yes. Which was also known as Little Theater of the Air.
Mm.
So, a little more Detroit history there for you. We actually did a tribute or two to Detroit radio in the past year in the Glowing Dial, and you can find those episodes in the Glowing Dial archives. How do you find the archives? Well, you go to glowingdial.com, and you click on shows, and the information is there for you. The latest show and how to listen and how to find the archives. All right, Greg, it is now time for that celebratory portion of the program, the one you love so well and do such a wonderful job with. It's the celebrity birthdays. And the Candrew sisters are over by their one microphone, gathered around it and ready to give us our musical accompaniment. So, ladies, if you would, take it away. Ladies and gentlemen, once more on the Glowing Dial, it is time for the celebrity birthday list, and here, with that thankless, arduous, no reward, no pay job, is Mr. Greg Barker. Take it away.
All right. Now, these birthdays are from October 4th through October 24th. Starting on the 4th, we have Catherine Card, actress for The Bartons and Uncle Walter's Doghouse. On the 5th, it's John Hoyt, actor for Escape and Suspense. On the 6th, we have Jerome Cohen, actor for Best Plays, Philip Morris Playhouse, and Suspense. On the 7th, we have Andy Devine for Wild Bill Hickok, Lum and Abner, and the Jack Benny program. On the 8th, we have Walter Schumann, composer for Dragnet and Junior Miss. On the 9th, we have John Tackerberry, writer for the Jack Benny program. On the 10th, Helen Hayes, actress for New Penny and Electric Theater. On the 11th, we have Jane Ace, comedian for Easy Aces, Jane Ace, and Disc Jockey. On the 12th, we have Josephine Hitchinson, actress for Edgar Bergen, Charlie McCarthy Show. On the 13th, Frank Remley, left-handed guitarist, and the Phil Harris Orchestra. On the 14th, it's Benita Hume, actress for Halls of Ivy and wife of Ronald Coleman. For the 15th, we have Ranson Sherman, actor for Fibber McGee and Molly and Haphazard. On the 16th, it's Barry Kruger, actor for The Falcon and Big Sister. On the 17th, it's Spring Byrington, actress for December Bride. On the 18th, it's Leo Carroll, actor for Lux Radio Theater and Man from U.N.C.L.E. on TV. On the 19th, Bob Sweeney for Sweeney and March and Sarah's Private Caper. On the 20th, Bela Lugosi, actor for Crime Does Not Pay. On the 21st, Hi Averback, announcer and actor for Seal Test Village Store, Bob Hope Show, and Take It or Leave It. On the 22nd, it's Parker Finelli, actor for Fred Allen Show and lawyer Dan Tucker. On the 23rd, it's Johnny Carson, announcer, disc jockey for Johnny Carson Show and The Tonight Show on TV, of course. And for the 24th, we have Ray Singer, writer for The Phil Harris Alice Faye Show and The Rudy Vallee Show.
Wow.
Wow.
A couple mispronunciations there, but
oh, I'm sorry.
We'll talk about that. back to the girls. And that be that. Parker Fennelly was one of the pronunciation there.
Ah.
Josephine Hutchinson, I think, not Hitchinson, but you know, he does. Greg does his best at these, and a lot of these are names he hasn't heard before. So
and,
you know.
Well, and this also proves that this is done by actual people, not robots, not digitally enhanced.
Danger, Will Robinson. Yes, robots. That was awful benign of me, wasn't it, to... I have no Robbie joke, so I'll just move on from there. Well, folks, if that wasn't enough birthdays, if you need more celebrity birthdays, visit our buddy Ron Sales' blog. He has them for the whole year, so you can see whose birthday you share. And to get there, you just go to glowingdial.com, click on links, and you'll see Ron Sales' celebrity birthday blog, and the link will be right there. Click on that, and drop Ron an email, too. Let him know what a good job he's doing compiling all that information, and tell him Big John and Steve / Greg / Stu. All my co-hosts, my whole corral of co-hosts here sent you over there.
It's true.
It's true. Well, you know what? We have three more westerns to bring you folks, and we're going to get to those right after this all-important message. Hi, Big John here to tell you about the greatest internet experience you'll ever have. And I'm talking about the Glowing Dial page. And to get there, all you have to do is simply point your browser to www.glowingdial.com. It couldn't be any easier. The Glowing Dial page is the internet presence for our old-time radio show, The Glowing Dial. There are so many things to see and do at the Glowing Dial page, we don't have time to list them all. But here's a few. Read mini bios of Steve, Stu, and myself and find out how the show came to be. Enter our latest contest and win a neat prize. Visit the photo gallery and view images of myself, Stu, and Steve, as well as some of our friends and OTR celebrities, too. Stop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. subscribe to our new podcast, and also enjoy classic episodes of The Glowing Dial. You can also subscribe to our blog and discussion list and keep up with all the latest Glowing Dial news and information. Stop by the Glowing Dial online store and purchase a wide variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. All that and more awaits you at the Glowing Dial page at www.glowingdial.com. See you there. And we're back with you, folks. We've got three more Westerns to bring you here in this Salute to Westerns on the Glowing Dial. And the next show is going to be an episode of Gunsmoke. Show that ran a long time on radio and a long time on TV as well. This is called The Photographer from Sunday, May 6th, 1956, original over CBS. This is starring William Conrad, Parley Bear, Georgia Ellis, Howard McNear, Lawrence Dobkin, Harry Bartell, James Nusser. George Walsh and George Fenneman are announcing the show, and the sponsor is Chesterfield Cigarettes. So here with a good deal of information on Gunsmoke is Mr. Gregg.
All right. Now, Gunsmoke is a perfect example of all of the elements of creative broadcast radio coming together week after week to create a place and time in your mind. In this case, Dodge City in the mid-1880s or so, populated with living people who you grow to know personally and care about. Chester, Doc, Kitty, and of course, Matt Dillon, U.S. Marshal. They become as real to us as our neighbors. The cast featured Parley Bear as Chester, Howard McNear as Doc, and Georgia Ellis as Kitty. The weekly supporting casts were always well-drawn and believable. Producer-director Norman MacDonald, the creative geniuses who made the show what it was, always took care that everything sounded just right. William Conrad, already a major radio actor with terrific work on Escape, was at first overlooked as being ubiquitous, but they tested him anyway. And he was Matt Dillon right from the start. The role became Conrad's greatest achievement, and must be considered as perhaps the best portrayal of a show's character ever heard on radio. Conrad was somewhat distraught that he wasn't considered to play Matt Dillon on TV, being short and heavy, but he went on to a solid career on TV, best remembered for the series Cannon. The radio show is Gunsmoke at its most creative and varied. The gritty dialogue of the superb scripts, the honest acting, sound effects, and music make Dodge as real as any place ever created on radio. For example, Kitty's saloon scenes featured a real honky-tonk piano being played live in a crowd of extras as the show was transcribed. Gunshots were the authentic weapons, recorded and carefully mixed. The production staff was considered the best in the business.
All right. Thank you very much, sir. And somewhere, there exists a Gunsmoke rehearsal, which got a little blue as they went along.
Oh, that I love to hear that.
Yeah. I don't know if we could feature that here on the show. I will have to actually take a listen to it.
We can play whatever we want.
But this is a family-oriented show, so we don't want to, you know, introduce any foul language or any and material that's too blue here, because, you know, we want the kids to be able to enjoy it, too. Although the kids probably know all the words that we're censoring anyway.
Wow, we hear that on TV now.
At least, yeah, exactly. There's TVMA stuff with commercial sponsorship now, so TV has changed a lot since the days that Gregg and I grew up watching it.
With, yeah, I was surprised when they came out with the product, Hell of a Good Dip. It's like, what? That's the name, Hell of a Good Dip.
Well, you didn't used to be able to say H-E double hockey sticks.
Yeah.
On the air.
Yeah.
On the Monkees episode, they made specific fun of that. Because Mickey was saying, you can't say on the air. And they blooped him out every time he said it. You know. NBC was probably one of the most prudish networks of all. At least I remember back in the late 70s, early 80s. They showed the film Meatballs with Bill Murray. You remember that?
Oh, yeah.
And at one point, Bill Murray says, you know, we import 50 hookers from around the world. And they blocked the word hookers with women. I said, wow, man. NBC, the prudiest network on the air. At least then. They've loosened up quite a bit with
the new management.
They have to compete with cable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they used to be the big three, NBC, CBS, and ABC. And if you live in Detroit, CBET, which was Channel 9, the CBC. But they didn't have as much cool stuff as we did. Then there was Fox, and then there was WB, and then there was UPN, and now CW, which our friend Chris thinks is his initials and thinks he owns the network. But anyway, it's time to get this episode going here, Greg. Let's extract it from the ether, if you would. Since we've heard all about the show, it's time to hear the show itself.
Doesn't ether knock people out?
No, it's ether is a drug that will knock you out, but it's also...
It's kind of confusing.
The early music of the theremin was called ether music.
Ethereal.
Ethereal. Ether music. Yeah, ether from the word ethereal. Mm. Yes, of course.
Don't you just love Latin?
In the 20s when they had concerts, they called it ether music.
Mm.
And that must have been really... kicked some major arse when that thing came on the market and people heard it the first time. Anyway, maybe we'll have a salute to the theremin with radio shows featuring theremin music.
Neat.
We can do that with The Lost Weekend. We've got, we've done that before, though. Anyway, I digress. Let us move on. And have you got the McGee machine in hand there, sir?
No.
No, it's sitting on the floor next to you. Yeah, I know.
Right.
I know.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Okay, fine.
I want a lever instead of a knob. Here we go.
Well, Stu has a crank handle for it, like a Model T.
That sounds like fun.
Folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Gunsmoke, this is The Photographer, from Sunday, May 6, 1956, originally over CBS.
Gunsmoke, brought to you by Chesterfield. Chesterfield packs more pleasure because it's more perfectly packed, thanks to Accuray. They satisfy the most. Around Dodge City and in the territory on West, there's just one way to handle the killers and the spoilers, and that's with a U.S. Marshal and the smell of gun smoke. Gunsmoke, starring William Conrad. The transcribed story of the violence that moved west with young America. And the story of a man who moved with it.
I'm that man, Matt Dillon, United States Marshal. The first man they look for and the last they want to meet. It's a chancy job, and it makes a man watchful and a little lonely.
Walk is just what I needed, Mr. Dillon. I sure been sleepy today.
You got spring fever, Chester.
I guess so. It is nice weather, ain't it? Won't be long now, the cattle drives will be starting.
Yeah, and the streets will be full of Texas cowhands looking for trouble.
Yes, sir. But you know, I'm almost looking forward to them this year.
And now, come July, you'll be pining for this peace and quiet.
Maybe, but not right now. Maybe I'll just stop by the tonsorial, Mr. Dillon, if it's all right with you.
Sure. Well, what for?
Well, like you said, it's spring. They got a bath there. Besides, it's time to get unsewed.
You better leave them on. We might have a late frost.
I don't know. I'm beginning to itch some. Hey, what's that crowd in front of the Long Branch?
I don't know.
What do you suppose it is, Mr. Dillon? Hey, maybe it's a medicine show.
Well, let's go take a look, huh?
Mm-hmm. Whatever it is, that fellow sure has drew a crowd, and that's a fact.
Uh-huh.
There he is. Miss Kitty's talking to him.
Yeah.
Well, guess there can't be no trouble, then.
Oh, hello, Matt.
Ah, Kitty.
Hey, Marshal. You come to have your picture took, too?
Yeah. The Marshal look real smart in a tintype, huh?
You tell him to.
Ah, so that's it. You're taking pictures, huh?
That's right, Matt. This is Professor Jacoby. He calls himself an artist of the camera.
Well, forevermore. So this is one of them things I've been hearing about.
That's right. Oh,
well,
keep your hands. What? Keep your hands off it, my good man. It's a very sensitive instrument.
Oh, yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Well, you're Marshal Dillon, I take it, sir.
That's right.
Well, I'm glad to meet you, Marshal. I was coming to look you up directly. Quite naturally, you're one of the subjects I most wish to immortalize with the camera.
Oh, is that so?
Certainly, certainly. Western Marshal is one of our great heroes back east.
They are, you don't say.
Oh, yes, yes.
Yes, Professor, what's that little tent for?
Oh, that's where I do my developing, sir.
Oh, developing?
Why, of course. Pyro and soda, you understand?
Well...
And the plate must be developed immediately before it dries.
Oh,
naturally. Now, miss...
Well, I'm as ready as I'll ever be.
You stand aside. If you'll just relax, miss.
Uh-huh.
I'm not going to shoot you, you know.
Okay.
Let me see. Now, that's not precisely what I'm after.
Hmm?
What we need is another subject.
I beg your pardon?
Oh, another person. You, sir, would you step up, please? Yes,
me.
You.
Me.
That's right. How do you like that? You're going to immortalize old Toad. Just come right over here, sir. That's it. That's it. Now, miss, if you'll just stand beside him.
Him?
Well, anything for art's sake, you know? We want this to look absolutely authentic.
I think I'm going to like this, Miss Kitty.
Now, don't go getting any ideas, Toad.
Ah, that's fine. That's fine. Now, miss, if you'll just look up at him with that... well, you know what I mean.
No, I don't know.
Well...
Professor, why don't you just take your pictures of people the way you find them? They'll be authentic enough.
Oh, no, of course, Marshal. I meant no offense.
That's all right, Matt. Go ahead, Professor.
Yes, of course. That's it.
Hey, where's he going? Look, ducking under that black cloth there.
Hey, well, you're going to have a hard time crawling into that little box.
That's good now. That's good now. Don't take your eyes off the camera and don't move a muscle while I'm counting. You understand?
Uh-huh.
All right, take a big breath. Hold it. One Missouri, two Missouri, three Missouri, four Missouri, five Missouri... Missouri, 7 Missouri, 8 Missouri, 9 Missouri, 10 Missouri, 11. Good, good.
Well, ain't that something, Mr. Dillon?
You know, I want to see that picture, Kitty. You look like the camera was a rattlesnake.
Well, it might as well have been. I'm glad it's over.
And now, Marshal. Marshal, maybe you will oblige.
Well, no, thank you, Professor. Maybe later.
Then perhaps I'll take one of these gentlemen here. You, sir. You look like a gunfighter.
No? Grubbs may try to look and act like a gunman, Professor, but he's not very desperate.
Oh, I see. Perhaps you have someone in your jail, Marshal.
No, not at the moment.
I know what the Eastern public wants, sir, what it wants to see. Dance hall girls and desperados, gunfighters, savage Indians, the violence of the West. And it's the violence I'm after most of all. That's what will sell my photographs.
Professor, then all you have to do is wait.
Wait for how long?
Oh, maybe a few weeks when the trail herds start coming.
Well, I haven't got a few weeks, Marshal.
Well, then I guess we can't help you.
Well, don't worry, Marshal. I'll manage.
No? How?
You'll see. I'm a man of ideas, Marshal.
That whistling man, Bobby Haggard, really started something. Tonight, we'd like to introduce a player piano that could have come right out of the Long Branch in Dodge City.
Packs more pleasure, packs more pleasure. Chesterfield packs more pleasure because Chesterfield's more perfectly packed.
It stands to reason a cigarette made better and packed better smokes better, tastes better, and Chesterfield is more perfectly packed by Accuray. This electronic miracle removes human error in cigarette manufacture. So Accuray Chesterfield is firm and pleasing to the lips, mild yet deeply satisfying. Yes, Chesterfield gives you something no other cigarette can give you.
Chesterfield packs more pleasure because Chesterfield's more perfectly packed.
To the touch, to the taste, Chesterfield packs more pleasure because it's more perfectly packed. Buy Chesterfield. Mild. Yet they satisfy the most. Sam.
Howdy, Marshal.
Morning, man.
Oh, hello, Kitty. Do you mind if I sit down?
Well, I haven't yet, have I?
Well, what are you grinning about?
I saw your picture. What was that you said to me about rattlesnakes?
Oh, yeah, it was pretty bad, wasn't it? Well, maybe if you didn't have to hold still for so long.
Sure. But... anyway, you're immortalized now. The professor will have your face all over the papers back east.
If they'll print it.
Matt, seriously.
Hmm?
I don't like that man.
Oh?
There's something about him. I don't know what it is.
Well, he seems all right, Kitty. Maybe you're just not used to photographers.
Well, neither are you.
Mr. Dillon?
Yeah, Chester.
Mr. Dillon, you better come.
Now, what's the matter?
Out at the end of Bridge Street, they just found Old Toad. He's dead.
Dead?
But that ain't all. He's been scalped.
What do you make of it, Matt?
I don't know, Doc.
Neither do I. There hasn't been any Indian trouble lately. Surely no Indian come this close to town.
Doc, it wasn't an Indian. That's not the way they use a knife.
Well, then who did do it, Mr. Dillon? Old Toad wasn't much good, but he never hurt nobody.
There's another funny thing, Matt. Doesn't look like it was done right here, but like it was done over there by that building. And then he was dragged out here into the open.
Yeah, out in the open. Into the sunlight. Now, wait a minute.
What are you looking for, Mr. Dillon?
This, right here, Chester.
Well, I don't see nothing.
Those three little marks on the ground there. You know what makes marks like that?
No, what?
The three-legged stand they use for a surveyor's instrument. Or a camera.
Camera? Matt. No man would do that just for a picture.
Well, there's one way to find out.
Come in, come in.
Ah, Marshal.
Ah, Professor. Looks like you're packing. You going someplace?
Yes, Marshal. I've covered Dodge pretty thoroughly. Now I want to go out onto the plains and get some pictures. You know, buffalo hunters, Indians.
Aren't you leaving kind of sudden?
Well, what do you mean? I've been planning to go down into the Indian territory.
Oh, they might be pretty dangerous right now, Professor.
Oh, I'm not timid, Marshal.
Oh, I know that. But did you hear there's Indian trouble starting? A man was scalped this morning right here in Dodge.
Yes, I heard something of it. But I'm not frightened.
Why not, Professor? Because you know it wasn't an Indian that did it?
Just what do you mean, Marshal?
I'd just like to know how you were able to get there and take a picture of Toad before anybody else knew anything about it.
Perhaps I was just lucky, Marshal? I met the man who found him.
I think it was more than luck. Are you accusing me of killing that man? Maybe you didn't do it yourself, but I think you hired it done.
Can you prove that?
I can when I find the man you hired.
The whole thing is ridiculous, Marshal. Besides, he was nothing but a scavenger, a derelict.
He was a man, and it was murder. Whoever did it will hang for it.
Well, it's no concern of mine. Unless, of course, I can take a photograph of the hanging.
You'll do anything for a picture, won't you?
Well, almost anything, Marshal. Like I told that girl, anything for art's sake. And that was a good picture I got of Toad, Marshal. Perhaps you'd like to see it.
No, thanks.
Well, it's going to be quite a feather in my cap when I take it back east to Harper's.
Maybe you won't take it back east, Jacoby. This might be one picture you paid too high a price for.
Why didn't you lock him up?
I got no proof against him, Doc, unless I can find the man who actually did it. And I got no idea who that is. Jacoby's been seen around town with a lot of men, but nobody's special.
He's liable to skip town on you.
Well, I hope so.
What's that?
Well, I figure he's going down into Indian territory. He won't go alone. Even he's not that foolish. And a logical one to go along with him is a man he'd already hired to do a job for him.
Yeah, that's so.
Anyway, it's the last chance I got.
The town sure stirred up about it. You'd never have thought old Toad had a single friend.
Sure, they're upset. They think it was Indians.
And the professor put the picture on display in the window of the Dodge house. Did you know that?
Yeah, I heard.
And maybe it was him started the talk about calling the cavalry out against the Indians.
Well, he'd like nothing better than an Indian war to photograph.
What kind of a man is that?
I don't know, Doug.
Mr. Dillon, Moss Grimmick says the professor left town just before dawn this morning.
Alone?
Nope. Tom Grubbs was with him.
Tom Grubbs. Sure. A two-bit would-be gunman. All right. Now all we gotta do is catch up with him.
Where are you listening to Gunsmoke? In your favorite easy chair? Or out driving? Oh, there you are. In the kitchen. Say, you want to make whatever you're doing more enjoyable? Have a Chesterfield. Enjoy Chesterfield's better taste and mildness. It stands to reason a cigarette made better and packed better smokes better, tastes better. And Chesterfield is more perfectly packed by Accuray. This electronic miracle removes human error in cigarette manufacture. So Accuray Chesterfield is firm and pleasing to the lips, mild yet deeply satisfying. Yes, Chesterfield gives you something no other cigarette can give you.
Chesterfield packs more pleasure because Chesterfield's more perfectly packed.
To the touch, to the taste, Chesterfield packs more pleasure because it's more perfectly packed. Buy Chesterfield, mild, yet they satisfy the most.
I like it, Mr. Dillon. I don't like it a little bit.
What, Chester?
All this Indian sign.
You just keep your eyes open. We'll manage. I guess Jacoby will be happy. He should be getting all the pictures he can use. I notice he's stopped several times.
Pictures? I hope I never meet another photographer.
Well, maybe they aren't all like him, Chester.
Well, I hope not.
Hold up, Chester.
What, Mr. Dillon?
Something over in that clump of weeds there.
Marshal.
What man? A white man, Mr. Dillon, it's Grubb.
Yeah, come on.
Marshal.
Mr. Dillon, he's been hurt bad. He's bleeding.
Yeah, he's been knifed.
Help me, Marshal.
Where's Jacoby?
Over there, somewhere. I don't know. I ran and hid.
What happened?
Indian. Cheyenne. I told Jacoby, but he wouldn't listen. I tried to tell him, but he wouldn't listen.
Told him what?
About the burial ground. Bad enough just being here. And then him trying to take pictures of Cheyenne. There was only three of them. When he saw him taking a picture the burial ground.
My goodness, that's bad, Mr. Dillon. They get awful mad when somebody fools around the burying place.
What did they do, Grubbs?
He attacked us. Fought one of them off and I ran and hid. I guess they couldn't find me.
Grubbs, why don't you tell me about it?
About what?
About Toad.
All right, I'll tell you. Professor gave me a lot of money. I guess I shouldn't have done it. Marshal?
Yeah?
I didn't even get my picture took. Ain't that...
He sure was some gunman, killing a helpless little old man for money.
Yeah. Now let's see about Jacoby now.
Hey, Mr. Dillon, you think them Cheyenne might still be around?
No, they just showed up by now, Chester.
There's the burial ground. Hey, look. There's his camera.
Yeah. All smashed.
And his pictures? All scattered around with... My gracious.
Chester, over here.
That ain't a nice sight, is it, Mr. John?
No. There's a kind of justice in it, Chester.
Yeah. They did to him just what he had Grubbs do to old Toad.
Well, we better bury him. Then maybe we better gather up those pictures.
What for?
We'll send them back east for him. Maybe they'll be immortal like he hoped. Who knows? He might turn out to be a big hero.
And wouldn't that be something?
Yeah. Not there have been heroes like that before. All right, come on.
A moment, our star, William Conrad.
Chesterfield packs more pleasure because Chesterfield's more perfectly packed.
A cigarette made better and packed better smokes better, tastes better, and Chesterfield is more perfectly packed by Accuray. This electronic miracle removes human error in cigarette manufacture, so Accuray Chesterfield is firm and pleasing to the lips. Chesterfield. Mild, yet they satisfy the most.
You know, at best, it was hard to scratch out a living on the high plains. But next week, hunger, disease, and a baby combined to defeat a man. And that was the West. Good night.
Gunsmoke, produced and directed by Norman McDonald, stars William Conrad as Matt Dillon, U.S. Marshal. The special music for Gunsmoke was composed and conducted by Rex Corey. Sound patterns by Ray Kemper and Bill James. Featured in the cast were Lawrence Dobkin, Harry Bartell, and James Nusser.
Harley Bear is Chester, Howard McNear is Doc, and Georgia Ellis is Kitty.
Live modern. Smoke L&M.
Live modern. Change to L&M.
Live modern. Smoke L&M. Only with L&M can you enjoy the full, exciting flavor of today's finest tobaccos. No other cigarette, plain or filter, gives you the full, exciting flavor you get through the pure white miracle tip. So light up, free up, let your taste come alive. Live modern. Smoke L&M.
Join us again next week for another specially transcribed story on Gunsmoke.
Top of the morning to you. This is Arthur Anderson. But let's pretend I'm Lucky the Leprechaun. You're listening to the Glowing Dial. Oh, you like the Glowing Dial. For us, said Arthur Anderson, it's magically nostalgic. That doesn't quite scan, does it? But you know what I mean.
We're back with you once again, folks. Hope you enjoyed Gunsmoke. That was The Photographer from Sunday, May 6, 1956, originally over CBS.
You know, John, I thought that episode was just a little overdeveloped.
Well, I would expect that comment coming from such an emotional fellow as yourself.
Well, but still.
Yeah. But still. I think you're overexposing yourself with your humor here, Greg. Your turn.
I got nothing.
Okay.
Oh, I just can't frame those jokes right.
You could have done, like, I'm sorry, it's the soap I'm using. It leaves an awful film on my arms, you know.
I'm just not focused enough, that's all.
Oh. One of those ectochrome moments.
Maybe you can lens me some material.
If you get a ghost picture, it's one of those ectoplasm moments, isn't it? Thank you, buddy. We didn't deserve it. We never do. But it's nice to have Ringo back with us.
Hey, Ringo!
Tip the drumsticks. There you go, sir. Yeah, he saluted you in the audience there, if you didn't see it. And you don't, because it says radio. We don't have a webcam, although we have considered that, but you would have to actually get to our website at a time when we are actually recording shows, because we don't do these live. I'd like to try that sometime, but getting the personnel over here, we got to grab Greg or Stu whenever their schedule permits.
Yeah, it's actually 4 a.m. right now.
Yeah, did you hear the crickets out there? Yeah. Buddy Holly couldn't make it this week. Anyway. All right. We've got two more Westerns to bring you, folks, and we're going to get to those right after this. Hi, Big John here to tell you all about the Glowing Dial online store. The Glowing Dial online store is your one-stop shop for all things Glowing Dial. You're sure to be fashionable with a t-shirt or sweatshirt emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. And your favorite beverage will taste even better in an official Glowing Dial mug or stein. How about a Glowing Dial tote bag so you can carry around your OTR with style and grace? Or be the first on your block to own Volume 1 of the Glowing Dial Celebrity Interviews on audio CD. You can surf the internet with class with an official Glowing Dial mouse pad. And if that weren't enough, we'll be adding more items with new logo designs in the near future. Remember, every time you purchase an item from our online store, you're helping to support us here at the Glowing Dial. You know, you don't even have to leave your home and trudge into your overcrowded, noisy mall. You can just sit comfortably in front of your computer and do all your shopping online. All you have to do is to point your browser to glowingdial.com, click on the Glowing Dial online store link. Then, through the wonders of internet technology, you would be instantly whisked to our store's main page. There, you'll see all the items we have to offer. You're sure to find something to suit your fancy. And remember, our official Glowing Dial items make great gifts, too. And the ordering process is simple and safe using CafePress.com's secure server. Most orders are shipped within 2 business days. You can even check on the status of an existing order. So head on over to the Glowing Dial online store, the only place you can get official Glowing Dial merchandise. So what are you waiting for? And we have returned, ladies and gents. It's time for an episode of Hop Along Cassidy now. This is The Case of the Last Word, from Saturday, January 6, 1951, and this aired on CBS and in syndication through Commodore Productions.
I hear they had a lot of pets.
We have another discrepancy here. Jerry Hannigan's logs, he has a lot of great radio episode guides or logs on his site, so make sure you go over there and otrsite.com and check those out. He says, his log says that the show is mutual at this point. However, our friend John Dunning says that it was CBS at this point. So we present both of those possibilities to you. And if anybody knows for sure which it is, please send us an email at go to glowingdial.com. Our emails, Steve and I, are right there on the main page. We'd like to hear from you no matter what. But if you have some information maybe that we got wrong or information that we can add, we'll be glad to announce it on a future show. So anyway, this is starring William Boyd and Andy Clyde. Greg is standing by. No, he's sitting by, isn't he? I always he always corrects me with that.
Not always.
With that wonderful T-shirt that he's wearing there. You want to see, folks? See, take a look over there.
See?
See? It's awesome.
Yes,
it really is.
It really is.
And you can own one for, no.
Anyway. $20.
And $20?
$20.
Where?
I forget.
The Glowing Dial gets no support from this one, of course.
Yeah, this was totally third party.
Maybe we can kind of rip it off by just, you know, photoshopping you and me sitting on top of the thing and making a Glowing Dial T-shirt out of it.
Hmm.
Or not.
Sounds weird.
Sounds very weird. Why would you and I be sitting on top of a naked woman? But anyway, all right.
Family show.
Greg is sitting by over there with some information on Hopalong Cassidy.
I am?
Yes, you are.
Oh, it's this here. Okay.
It's in your hand.
It's in my hand.
In front of your face.
Right. It says, CBS produced an audition episode of Hopalong Cassidy program that was broadcast in the summer of 1941 as part of Forecast, a series of pilots for potential programs. After that, little, if anything, was heard about Hopalong Cassidy radio production until 5 years later. An item in Radio Life in 1946 commented, "Radio's gone Western with a vengeance, as if you didn't know." And reported that a radio version of the Cassidy movies would be heard in the near future. That near future turned out to be 2 years later. The program has been classified as both a juvenile adventure program and a Western adventure drama. As was true of the movies and television programs featuring Hopalong Cassidy, the character was much more civilized than the rough-cut character portrayed in the novels by Clarence Mulford. In contrast, the revised Cassidy was described by radio historian John Dunning as a knight of the range, a man of morals. A newspaper story about the program's debut on Mutual Radio commented, "The radio broadcasts will be specially scripted to highlight the personality, mannerisms, and unusual adventures of the steely-eyed, justice-stealing, gun-toting cowboy hero." William Boyd played Hopalong Cassidy, as he had in the movies. Dunning wrote, "Boyd has one of the radio's perfect voices. His voice could do anything. Comfort a bereaved widow one moment, and scare the boots off her husband's killer the next." Andy Clyde, the resident old coot sidekick from the later movies, reprised his role in the radio program. Each episode's opening referred to Clyde's character, California Carlson, as "the same California you've laughed at a million times." After a slow start, the popularity of the Hopalong Cassidy on radio began to increase. In 1948, a Hopalong Cassidy television series began. First shown on KTLA in Los Angeles, That series included both edited versions of Cassidy's movies and new episodes made for TV. Dunning wrote, "One medium fed on the other. For 2 years, Boyd was as big a media hero as the nation had seen." Both the radio and television versions of Hopalong Cassidy benefited from the existing popularity the Cassidy character had developed through movies. The producers made good use of that popularity in promoting the syndicated program to stations and advertisers. An ad in the 1949 issue of Broadcasting Yearbook proclaimed, 13 years of motion picture popularity behind it. No other radio series can make this claim. The Hopalong Cassidy radio series was syndicated via electrical transcription by Commodore Productions, beginning in 1948 and continued into 1950. Network broadcasts began on Mutual January 1st, 1950, and ended on CBS December 27th, 1952.
All right. So, like we said before, we had a discrepancy. One source says it was Mutual at this point of this episode, and one other source says it was CBS. So take both of those with a grain of salt, if you would.
One of the great mysteries.
We gave you the air date of this episode. We also have a recording date, a Commodore Productions recording date of February 6, 1950. So that's when it actually was laid down on transcription. Wasn't aired till almost a year later. So nothing remains but for us to extract this episode from the ether for you. The ethereal plane.
More ether.
Broadcasts from yesteryear still exist and can be pulled in by our wonderful McGee machine. Magical radio. Inspired by none other than Fibber McGee.
Ta-da!
Ta-da! Maybe we should tell that story a little more often. It's how it... how the McGee machine came to be. Anyway, but that won't be now. I'm going to get this episode to you. So, Greg, if you would...
It's on your, the knob. You,
you're manipulating those knobs, aren't you? All right.
and loving every minute of it.
How did Beavis get in here? Anyway, yeah. There we go. Ah, there we go.
Yeah.
Familiar sound of static, meaning the McGee machine is working hard to pull this episode in for you. Folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Hopalong Cassidy. This is the case of the last word from Saturday, January 6, 1951, over CBS and in syndication.
With action and suspense out of the Old West comes the most famous hero of them all, Hopalong Cassidy, starring William Boyd. The Ring of the Silver Spurs heralds the most amazing man ever to ride the prairies of the early West, Hopalong Cassidy, the same Hoppy you cheer in motion pictures, and the same California you've laughed at a million times. Raw courage and quick shooting have built a legend around this famous hero. Hopalong is a name to be feared, respected, and admired, for this great cowboy rides the trails of adventure and excitement. William Boyd as Hopalong Cassidy and Andy Clyde as California. Well, Hoppy, what about our story?
California and I were in a little cow town called Trail Center. We had just unsaddled our horses at the stable and were walking leisurely toward the two-story frame building that passed for a hotel. It had been a long ride from the bar 100 miles to the east, and our throats were parched with alkali dust. California was unhappy with the situation.
Hoppy, what we doing way over here? We got better dust than this back at the bar 20.
I know, California, but we've got to have provisions.
What's the matter with Tamarack? It's a sight closer than this place.
A man has to move around once in a while. He gets stale if he doesn't.
Hoppy, you got something up your sleeve.
Maybe. I don't know yet.
Hoppy! Hopalong Cassidy!
Looks like somebody knows you, Hoppy.
Oh, it's good to see you, Hoppy. What are you doing over this stretch of sagebrush?
Hello, Andrew. We came over to buy provisions. This is Andrew Fillmore, California, one of the finest men who ever came west.
Howdy, Fillmore.
Glad to know you, California.
How are things going with you, Andrew?
Oh, not so good lately, Hoppy.
What's the trouble?
Well, there's been a series of bank robberies in these parts. All of us little ranchers, Monty and I have cleaned out.
That's so.
Yeah.
Seems to me I heard something about it over my section.
I knowed it.
You knew what, California?
I knowed it wasn't no provision buying trip.
Well, what are we doing then?
Your old hankering for chasing trouble get the bastards off you. That's what.
Hoppy, does he mean that you're going to...
Simmer down, Andrew. I'm not looking for trouble.
Oh, shucks. Sure a man can take care of it if it comes your way.
Right now, I'd like some sarsaparilla coming my way. My throat's kind of dry.
Now, there's a sensible idea, and I'll buy.
What's that?
Hoppy, look. Coming out of the bank.
Yeah, two masked men.
Uh-oh, I'm getting me some cover.
They're getting away.
Not yet, they're not.
What are you going to do, Hoppy?
Bring them down if I can.
You got the one on the bay.
Wait a minute. The Pinto's getting out of range. I missed him.
Well, come on. This is going to tell us who's been robbing our bank lately.
Sorry, I missed the other one.
No use having any more killing than necessary. And get that mask off of that dead one, we'll know who the gang is.
Here. Now, get the bandana off his face.
Now, wait a minute.
There.
Uh-oh.
Well, you know him, Andrew?
Yeah, I know him.
Who is he?
My daughter was right after all.
What did you say?
That there's Willie Cranball.
Who is Willie Cranball?
Oh, he's the kid brother of Bart Cranball, biggest cattleman this side the river.
What does that prove?
Unfortunately, nothing, Hoppy. Willie didn't need no money. His brother's got enough for the whole county. He's probably out on a lark and got himself killed.
You really believe that, Andrew?
Well, I don't know what to believe. But, Hoppy, you've got trouble now.
How so?
Bart Cranball. He's a vengeful man. He's a powerful man. He won't let this pass.
Andrew, this man was robbing a bank, and that calls for direct action. As far as I'm concerned, it's a job for the sheriff now. And if Bart Cranball wants to settle the score, I'll be right over there at the hotel.
Now, back to Hopalong Cassidy and the case of the last word. The body of the dead bank robber is circled with curious townsfolk. Hoppy and California have nothing more to do, so they push their way through the awestruck crowd to the hotel. They're registering for a room when the sheriff, a big man with a wall eye and a chin like a badger, comes swaggering up to them.
Your name, Cassidy?
That's right.
I'm the sheriff of this here township.
So I gather.
Huh?
That's a big badge you're wearing.
Now, look here, don't...
This is my partner, California Carlson. We're from the Bar 20, 100 miles to the east.
Howdy.
Howdy. Cassidy, we don't like strangers coming in here and shooting up our folks.
Young Cranball was robbing the bank.
Well, that may be, but it's my job to see that justice is done around here, not yours.
You weren't around, Sheriff.
Well, that don't make no difference. I would have taken out after him, and I would have brought him back alive.
Like you did the boys who stuck up the banks in Soda Junction, Saltwater Bend, and Harrison Flats?
Well, they got away, but we'll get them yet.
How do you know Willie Cranball didn't pull those stick-ups, too?
Are you trying to tell me how to do my job?
Not at all, Sheriff.
Well, let me give you a friendly warning. Bart Cranball ain't no man to take things light. He's going to be mad when he finds out you shot his brother.
Since we're just visitors here in Trail Center, we can expect your protection if it's needed, can't we, Sheriff?
Well, sure. But if I was you, I'd get out of town. And right soon.
Advice is something you can act on two ways, Sheriff. You can take it, or you can leave it. But I'll remember what you said. Come on, California, let's wash off some of the dust.
Nothing like a thick steak to put a man to rights inside.
And a store-bought bed to put your head on afterwards.
Yes, sir. This is comfort. We ought to come into town more often, Hoppy.
Seems like I always get into trouble when I do.
Oh, that kid had it coming to him this afternoon, Hoppy. He'd have got you first if he could.
Yeah. Well, let's turn in and get some sleep. We're going to need it on the trail tomorrow.
We're going back tomorrow?
Sure.
Shucks, I never have no luck. Well, good night, Hoppy.
Aren't you even going to take your boots off, California?
Huh? Sure, the boots. What do you want to go back today for, Hoppy? We won't get a chance to eat like this again for maybe 6 months.
You've already plowed through 2 orders of ham and eggs and potatoes, California.
No, that ain't nothing. I'm going to have some more of them for dessert.
You're going to look like a steer at shipping time.
Are you Hopalong Cassidy?
Huh? Yeah. And you'd be Bart Cranball.
I got a little score to settle with you, Cassidy.
I'm sorry about your brother, Cranball.
Being sorry isn't enough. I'm going to have you and this whiskered specimen you call your partner run out of town on a rail.
What for?
Let's say for taking the law into your own hands.
I might sue you for that, Cranball.
You're lucky I don't feel like shooting you.
You're wearing a gun. Would you care to reach for it?
I don't operate that way, Cassidy. I get what I want without shooting.
Well, looks like we have more company, California.
Yeah.
Morning, Sheriff. Something on your mind?
Is your glove, Cassidy?
Glove? Let me see. Well, yeah.
Then I'm putting you and your partner under arrest.
And what's the charge?
Murder.
Murder? Who?
The bank guard was shot last night. This glove was found by his body.
I see. What made you think this might be my glove, Sheriff?
Why, it's just like the ones I saw you wearing yesterday. I put two and two together.
Mighty good detective work. It so happens I left that glove with its mate in my blanket roll down at the stable.
Yeah, that's what you say. I say you sneaked out of your room in the hotel last night, shot the guard, and tried to rob the bank.
Well, Cassidy?
That detective work isn't so good. Neither California nor I left our room last night.
Oh, Hoppy, we...
And if you gentlemen will come to the room with us, I'll prove it.
Looks as if I won't have to run you out of town on a rail. You've got yourself set for a necktie party on your own hook.
Like I said, I can prove we never left that hotel room.
All right, Cassidy. I don't know what your game is, but we'll go along.
Sheriff?
Sure.
I knew you'd want to see the law was upheld. Come along, gentlemen. All right, Cranball. Sheriff, put up your hand.
Hey, what's the...
I thought you'd try something like this. You know, of course, we'll string you up when we catch you.
I know what I'm doing. California, get the horses and bring them around back. Hurry.
Yeah, Hoppy, sure.
Just make yourselves comfortable, gentlemen, but don't reach for your gun.
You can't do this. I'm the sheriff.
You aren't as smart as I thought you were, Cassidy. You're proving yourself guilty of murder.
Maybe. Now turn around. I'm going to tie a few knots with a rope while I do some unraveling in my mind. Yeah?
It's me, California.
Come on in.
The horses are out back, Hoppy. You sure you know what you're doing?
I'll tell you later. Right now, let's get out of here.
You're going to leave them all trussed up and gagged like that?
Sure, they'll get out in an hour or so. But that time, we'll be long gone. Let's go.
Hoppy! Hey, Hoppy!
Who's that?
Andrew Fillmore, but I haven't got the time to talk to him.
Where are we going, Hoppy?
Out there, California. Just keep riding. Let's go, Topper. Pull up in that draw over there, California.
Sure, Hoppy, sure.
It's about time we took a breather.
When are you going to tell me what this is all about?
After I do some figuring. Right now, I don't like being railroaded out of town.
Seems to me you did that for us.
No, I just beat them to it. You know, California, I don't think we were wanted in Trail Center.
That's all right with me.
Most people get thanked for stopping a bank robbery. We're going to stick around and see why we're different.
We go back to that town, they'll give us a plot of ground 6 feet deep.
We aren't going back to town.
Huh? Then what are we going to do?
We're going to sit and talk to the rattlesnakes till the sun goes down. And do some thinking.
Bart Cranbaugh sure got himself a big spread here, Hoppy, huh?
Yeah.
We must have covered 2 miles since we left the horses.
Let's stop a minute. The moon's a little too bright to go walking along like we owned the place.
What you looking for, Hoppy?
First, I want to get the lay of the land. That's the corral down to our left, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's the ranch house in the knoll, straight ahead. I can see the chimney.
Not a light on the place.
I reckon the boys ain't back from town yet. It's Sunday night, you know.
Listen.
Somebody's coming in fast.
Get down, California.
I am down. Hoppy, that was Bart Cranbaugh.
It wasn't Billy the Kid.
Look, he's gone right to the ranch house.
Yeah.
Are we gonna jump him?
Maybe. First, we got to know how many we're up against. Let's check the corral for horses.
What's that gonna prove?
Well, if there aren't any horses, that's a pretty fair indication Cranbaugh's alone.
Sure.
You circle the left and I'll take the right. I'll meet you on the side nearest the house.
I got your hobby.
And be careful.
Put up your hands.
What?
Quick.
Yes, sir.
Come closer. Easy now. I've got some questions I want to ask you.
Hey! Drop it, fella. Drop it, I said.
Good work, California. Now drag him out here in the moonlight.
Come on, you.
Everybody wears a mask in this part of the country.
You'll have to take it off, Hoppy. The critters are extra as a mountain lion.
All right, California. Hang on. Now, out.
What's the matter?
He just bit me.
Hurry up, Hoppy.
There. That does it.
Oh, let me go. Let me go.
Well, I'll be... California, you heard the lady. Let her go.
Now, back to Hopalong Cassidy and the case of the last word. Hoppy and California have been reconnoitering the Bart Cranbaugh layout when Hoppy is ordered to put up his hands. California jumps the gunman from behind, but he turns out to be an active young lady.
I've never fought with a lady before, California. What do I do now?
Wasn't you, was me. Darn near licked me, too. Better find out who she is.
Oh, sure. Nearly forgot my manners. Miss, my name's Hopalong Cassidy, and this is my partner, California Carlson.
What? Hopalong Cassidy? Well, I thought you'd been run out of town.
You know me, huh?
Well, I'm Julie Fillmore, Andrew Fillmore's daughter.
Well, pleased to meet you, Julie. But what are you doing on Cranbaugh's ranch toting a gun?
I thought you were Bart Cranbaugh.
But why did you want to jump in for?
Because I know he's been behind those bank robberies that cleaned out my father and all the other small ranchers.
What makes you so sure?
I just know, that's all. A woman's intuition.
Oh, I see.
If it hadn't been for you, I might have had my proof by now.
But what have I done?
You killed Willie Cranbaugh.
He was robbing a bank. Besides, I don't see
Let me tell you. I'd known Willie Cranbaugh practically all my life. He was weak, and he'd do anything his brother told him. I got to figuring if I could get next to Willie and make him talk, he'd incriminate his brother Bart. I was building him up easy when you came along and killed him.
We should have gotten together sooner.
All I can do now is try to force the truth out of Bart at gunpoint.
We're in this too, Julie.
Well, I didn't expect any help from you after Dad told me you tied up the sheriff and Bart and skipped town.
Does your dad know you're doing this?
Oh, no. He'd stop me if he knew.
Julie, there's more than one way to catch a gopher. Besides, California and I have to clear our names. You want to join forces?
Sure, but what can you do? Even Dad would have to help string you up if you went back to town.
Did they send a posse after us?
Why, Why, no. The sheriff said you'd left the county.
I thought so.
Does that mean something to you?
It means we played right into their hands by outlawing ourselves from Trail Center.
What are you going to do?
Cranbaugh's up at the ranch house right now, alone.
Yes, I know. I was hiding by the gate when he came in.
We'll take care of things now. You ride into town and tell the sheriff that you saw Californian be headed out this way. And you overheard me say I had proof of who killed the bank guard.
Do you?
No.
Well, then what?
You'll see when the time comes.
Well, shall I come back after I talk to the sheriff?
That won't be necessary. We'll handle it from now on.
All right. I'll wait for you at the hotel.
Now ride, Julie, and make it as fast as you can.
Evening, Sheriff.
Well, evening, Miss Fillmore. Out kind of late, ain't you?
I just saw something important.
What's that?
Hopalong Cassidy in California riding toward Grandpa's ranch.
What? Are you sure?
I not only saw them, I heard them.
What'd they say?
Well, Cassidy said he had proof who killed the bank guard.
But he did.
I'm only telling you what I heard.
Well, he's a dangerous man. I'll have to get a posse together and go after him right away.
Why didn't you do it earlier today?
He wouldn't dare show his face after tying me and Bart up. He knows we'd hang him.
Oh, I hope you catch him, Sheriff.
You leave it to me, Miss Fillmore. That hombre won't cause no more trouble around here.
Oh, that's the spirit, Sheriff. You know, we need more men like you in public office. Well, I guess I'll get on home.
Good night, Miss Fillmore.
Good night, Sheriff.
Rance, come in here.
What's the trouble, Sheriff?
Got some riding to do.
This time of night?
Julie Fillmore was just here.
Oh.
Said she saw Hopalong Cassidy and his partner heading for Cranbaugh's ranch.
Well, I thought they'd been scared out of town.
We gotta get out there.
Oh, sure have.
I'll go ahead. You follow in about 15 minutes and cover me.
Want me to get a posse together?
No. We gotta handle this by ourselves. We'll tell everybody about it afterwards.
Watch where you're putting your feet, California.
I'm trying to.
Now, take off your hat and I'll hold you up to the window.
Sure, Hoppy.
What's Grandpa doing?
He's standing on a chair, playing with the antlers over the fireplace.
Hey, look.
We're not play-acting, California. What was he doing?
I tell you, Hoppy, he was playing with the antlers.
All right. Now let's ease around to the porch.
We gonna rush him, Hoppy?
Yeah. You stay behind me. I'll hit the door first.
I got you.
Your gun's ready?
Sure are.
Here we go.
Wait, Cranbaugh.
What? Cassidy.
Fire and keep him up there.
I thought you'd have sense enough to be 30 miles away by now.
You were a little too anxious for that to happen, Cranbaugh. And we're gonna find out why.
Mark. Mark, let me in.
Who's there?
It's me, the sheriff.
Just a minute.
When I didn't see any light, I didn't know whether you were here or not. I think we're in for trouble, Bart. Julie Fillmore told me in town that Cassidy and California was headed this way.
Hmm?
Yeah, and she heard Cassidy say he had proof who killed the bank guard. Maybe he did see me shoot him last night.
Hmm.
And another thing, he might find out we got that bank money hidden behind them antlers over the fireplace. If he does, he's going to go after the U.S. Marshal. We ought to take it to a safer place, Bart.
Good idea. We'll need a light.
Well, I reckon we could get it in the dark.
No, we'll chance it.
There, that's better.
Yeah, now I'll just...
Don't move, Cassidy. And don't reach, Sheriff. California's behind you.
How did you get...
Drag Cranbaugh in here, California. I'll hold a gun on the sheriff.
Coming up, Hoppy.
You talk a lot for a sheriff. The wrong kind of talk.
I didn't do nothing, Cassidy. Bart,
save your breath. Get that gag off and untie him, California.
I'm working on him.
I thought you boys worked awful smooth together. Now, let me tell you something. So do California and I.
Of all the dumb fool people I have to get tied up with.
I thought that he was you, boy.
Shut up, both of you. You're going to have a long talk with a U.S. Marshal. And I don't think he's going to like what you'll have to say.
Shall I get the money from behind the antlers, Hoppy?
Yeah, might as well take it along.
Hey, this bag's heavy.
It should be. Results of 3 bank robberies in it. All right, march you two, and don't try anything.
Drop those guns, both of you.
At a boy ranch.
I've done just like you told me, Sheriff.
Well, this puts a shoe on the other foot, huh, Cassidy?
Seems that way.
And this is for tying me up twice in the same day.
Why are you hit Hoppy again on us?
Go ahead if it makes you feel better.
Well, what are we going to do, Bart? Shoot him?
No, we're going to string him up on the willow down by the spring.
Well, what'll people think?
What we want them to. These two are wanted for murder. I caught them snooping around here, sent for you, and we hung them.
Sure.
Rance, now I'm glad Cassidy got my brother yesterday instead of you.
Good thing I got here in time.
Cassidy, and you dirty rattlesnake, move. We'll make this as quick and painful as possible.
Now, back to Hopalong Cassidy.
All right, Sheriff. See, they don't try to get away. Hey, Rance, get a couple of ropes over that lower limb.
Yeah, Bart.
You got anything to say, Cassidy? It's gonna be your last word.
Wouldn't do much good to say anything, would it, Cranbaugh?
Ain't there nothing we can do, Hoppy?
Somebody's coming, Bart.
That's just the boys coming back from town. Get on with it.
Hoppy,
quiet, California. Cranbaugh, how about making a deal? We'll take off and never come back if you'll let us go.
I knew you'd eat dirt before we finished with you.
I mean it.
Now, Sheriff, get him on those horses. We're wasting time.
All right, mount up there. Hold still. Keep these nooses around your neck.
You ready, Sheriff?
Not quite. Hey, Bart, Sheriff, those ain't the cowhands coming. It's somebody else.
What?
Bart?
What?
Hey! You're surrounded, Cranbaugh. Drop that gun, Sheriff. You won't be needing it now.
One of them's getting away.
I'll get him, Fillmore.
Hoppy, California, you all right?
Yeah, Andrew, we're all right.
Oh. Yeah, sure.
Cranbaugh's toting your gold, Andrew.
Oh, thanks, Hoppy. All right, boys. Take Cranbaugh and the sheriff. The marshal can have him now.
That was a close one, Andrew. Thanks for coming.
Oh, don't thank me, Hoppy. Thank Julie.
Julie? Yeah.
Hello, Hoppy. California?
He's the one rounded us up, made us come out here.
You got a smart daughter, Andrew.
I figured this would require a woman's touch before it was finished.
You sure figured right, Miss Julie.
How did you happen to come back when I said we wouldn't need you?
When I saw the sheriff leave town by himself and Rance follow a few minutes later, well, I got the drift.
Well, you proved it once again, Julie.
What's that, Mr. Cassidy?
It's the woman who always has the last word.
This ends the case of the last word. But it isn't even the beginning of the excitement that's in store for Hopalong Cassidy. It involves the terrifying circumstances of a boy being hunted for murder. A murder Hoppy feels sure he didn't commit. Hoppy calls this story Bad Medicine at Rimrock, and we know you won't want to miss it. So remember to be with us for another fast-moving episode of Hopalong Cassidy. Hopalong Cassidy, starring William Boyd, is transcribed and produced in the West by Walter White, Jr. The Case of the Last Word was written by Alan Botzer. All stories are based upon the characters created by Clarence E. Mulford. This is a Commodore production.
Hello there. This is CBS Mystery Theater. It's Corrine Orff. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
Back with you once again, folks. Hope you enjoyed Hopalong Cassidy. That was The Case of the Last Word from Saturday, January 6, 1951, over CBS and in syndication through Commodore Productions. And again, we have the discrepancy that we have two different sources. One says that it was CBS at that time. One says it was Mutual at that time. So those two can battle it out in the ether, and the winner can come to us and tell us which one it is.
I have a question.
I might have an answer.
Okay. Why did they call him Hopalong?
Because Ride Along Cassidy did not have the same impact.
Of course. Why didn't I think of that?
Well, because in the early days, before he got his horse, he went around in a bunny outfit. Here comes Hopalong Cassidy. Chasing you and chasing me.
The drugs are wearing off, America.
California's with him by his side. Boom, 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 boom. Everybody sing along. Along. There, I sang along. Get it?
They're coming to take him away, huh?
Again, Ringo, we didn't deserve it. But I think he's contractually obligated now to do a certain amount per show. Even if we say, like, somebody just passed away, Ringo will go, you know. But no, you wouldn't do it for a funeral. You wouldn't do it for somebody passing away.
He's got more class than that.
And you know what I just heard?
A little more class than that.
Of course, the time we're cutting this show is a little bit into August. But Peg Lynch passed away. She created, wrote, directed her own shows, Ethel and Albert. And then The Couple Next Door, which I think we featured here on The Glowing Dial before, 15-minute shows. I had the opportunity to see her at a convention once.
Cool.
With Parley Bear, and they did an Ethel and Albert sketch, and it was hilarious. The way they read it, it was like dialogue one over the other, kind of Howard Hawks style.
Did you record it?
No.
I
didn't have a recorder with me there at that one. It was a Cincinnati radio convention back in the late 90s. But we didn't get a chance to do a celebrity interview with her, unfortunately, because she was there and gone very fast at the convention.
At the convention.
But she just passed away. So
that's too bad.
Rest in peace, Peg Lynch. Now, moving on, we have one more Western to bring you. That's going to be an episode of The Cisco Kid, and we're going to tell you all about that right after this. Hi, Big John here to tell you how you can help support The Glowing Dial. You know, it takes a lot of time and effort to maintain The Glowing Dial page and produce new episodes of the show. It also takes something we usually don't have enough of, money. The Glowing Dial page and show are nonprofit entities, and all costs incurred come out of our pockets, and we could use a little help from you, our listeners. There are several ways you can help support The Glowing Dial, and all of these methods can be accessed on our main page at www.glowingdial.com. One way to support us is to check on the PayPal donation box icon on our main page and make a donation. It can be as little or as much as you can afford. Every little bit helps. Another way is to purchase items from the Glowing Dial online store through cafepress.com. There you will find an ever-increasing variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. You can also shop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Every time you order something from our bookstore, you are helping to support the Glowing Dial. If you're a fan of Dick Organ's radio work, then why not order the complete set of Chicken Man episodes on CD? Just scroll down our main page until you see those silly dancing chickens. Purchase of this set also helps to support us here at The Glowing Dial. So there you have it, folks. Four ways that you can help support us and ensure the continuation of The Glowing Dial page and show. We thank you in advance. We're back with you once again, folks. It's time now for an episode of The Cisco Kid, or The Cisco Kid, if you prefer. This is called Night Riders of Red Rock. It's from the mid-1950s. We don't have an exact air date on that. Sorry about that. But it was on the Mutual Don Lee Network and in syndication as well. Starring Jack Mather, Harry Lang, and the sponsor is Butternut Bread. But I believe in syndication the sponsor varied in different areas of the country. Sitting by, making all kinds of silly motions and staring at me and trying to make me laugh while I'm reading this, is Greg. So get ready, Greg, when you're reading that.
All right. The Cisco Kid, along with his companion Pancho, were Mexican adventurers, outlaws who victimized the rich and greedy, but often found themselves on the run from the law. Jackson Beck and Louis Sorin, in the Mutual Radio series, adopted an Americanized Mexican dialect. According to Radio Life in 1947, a favorite plot was to have the sheriff and his posse suspect Cisco and Pancho. The two would perpetuate the hoax, so the real cowboy crooks would let down their guard. The camaraderie on the trail was a constant. To Cisco, Pancho was Chico, and their allegiances were first and foremost. Though Cisco would often scold his partner for stupidity, no other man was allowed to denigrate his friend. Cisco was a fighter, a formidable foe with both fist and guns. The fights, especially in the Jack Mather syndications, were wildly verbal, with Cisco and Pancho jabbering away in the thick of fisticuffs. The furious finish, with more chatter, punches, and broken chairs, and the final sound of a bad man taking a fall. These fights today are considered hilarious, like a B-movie western in which the hero never loses his hat. The opening was pure radio, a sound of racing hoofbeats, then gunshots, then the urgent cries of the heroes, and the closings were also done to formula. There was also a señorita. Said Radio Life, for each dark-eyed conquest he had a string of pearls, who Cisco claimed belonged to his sainted mother. This was followed by a kiss before he rode off with Pancho into a blazing desert sunset. Up came the dreamy organ music. The señorita would breathe, "Oh, Cisco." And Cisco would answer, "Oh, señorita." The action would cut to the trail, with Cisco and Pancho riding away on their horses Diablo and Loco. There was always a terrible closing pun by Pancho, with Cisco reacting in great disgust. Then there would be whooping laughter, the sounds of galloping horses, and the music playing out. Nice try. John was over here trying to do the same thing.
I was heckling him through the whole damn thing. He was silently.
No, I heard that.
If we had a... I was doing this with my stapler in front of the mic. I was going to tell you it was the Staple Singers.
Oh. Well, yeah. we'll clip that out.
Oh, a clip joint. Speaking of which, here we got a Three Stooges Film Festival coming up at the Redford.
That would be the Redford Theater in Redford, Michigan.
If you're in the area, folks, in southeast Michigan, Redford Theater is an awesome little place. Still got a pipe organ from the 1920s that's been restored.
It's really cool watching them play live.
It's very good watching somebody play their organ.
What's neat is when he starts playing the organ, you don't see the organ. It rises up from the from under the floor.
Rory Loke used to have that, too, but they tore it out years ago. But I remember as a kid seeing it there once at least. Anyway, there's a commercial for the Redford Theater.
And no residuals are expected.
No residuals, just a lot of sweat because it's hot in the studio right now. Anyway, thank you, sir, for that information. And you didn't break one. Well, you did. You broke a few times there. But
Though actually, that wasn't because of you. That was I just stumbled on the words.
It wasn't because of me. Yeah.
And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
I made your ass nervous, man. I did. Why does that sound like Amos and Andy? Holy mackerel, Andy. It's time to extract this episode from the ether for the good people listening to us, all three of them. Well, I actually hope it's more like
probably
four or
three
five.
Now.
More like four or five, maybe. And they're tuning out one by one here every second.
Trust us, it does get better.
Yeah, the show is going to be so bad, Jerry Hand, because it's going to send it back to me. Here, I don't want it. All right.
I've been threatened. Don't play this.
Don't play this or else. Well, folks, if you don't want us to play it, send us money and we won't play it.
Oh, yeah. The more money, the less we'll play.
I got enough to fix up my house and pay my taxes and, the show will change drastically. and actually be entertaining. Ba-dum-bump. All right, fine. Greg, if you would reach for the McGee machine there, let's
I've got it.
Stop this frivolity and get things going for the good people here.
And moving on up.
There. You're looking at the Jeffersons over here, aren't you? Wheezy! Folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember the Cisco Kid. This is Knight Riders of Red Rock from the mid-1950s on Mutual Don Lee and in syndication.
Here's adventure! Here's romance! Here's the famous Robin Hood of the Old West.
Cisco, the sheriff, he is getting closer.
This way, Pancho, Domino.
The Cisco Kid.
Three meals a day, 7 days a week. That's how often bread is served in the average home. And that's why bread, the right bread that is so very important. And once you become accustomed to this little tune...
Tut, tut, nothing but butternut bread.
Yes, when you always remember that, you're getting the finest out of the bread you serve every meal, every day. You see, butternut bread, every loaf you buy, is always of the finest, softest, freshest quality. And we make this claim because we know that butternut is baked to the same uniform standard of highest quality every time. And say, the butternut wrapper shows you its quality before you buy. There's a full, true-to-life picture on every blue and white check gingham butternut wrapper. No guess, no squeeze, no doubt. You can be sure of the most appetizing, most delicious bread when you buy butternut bread. So next time, every time, always buy butternut in the blue and white check gingham picture wrapper.
And now the Cisco Kid in our exciting story, Knight Riders of Red Rock. When Bud and Claire Morland settled in the town of Red Rock, Arizona, it was quiet and peaceful, but within 2 years it became one of the roughest, most lawless places on the frontier. Small ranchers lost their holdings, either through rustling or being burned out. It seemed like a well-organized plan, yet no one was able to point a finger and accuse any of the other townsfolk of the crimes. It remained for the famed Cisco Kid to solve the mystery. As our story opens, a masked rider thunders toward a grove of barely visible cottonwood trees in the moonlight.
This way! Ah! Hold! Hold there! Hold! Easy there! Hold now!
Good evening, boss. We're ready and waiting.
Very good, Tipton. Are all your men here?
Every last one of them. None of them want to get left out of the looting.
All right. Now, tonight you ride against the Running M Ranch.
Bud Moreland's spread. Well, that suits us fine, don't it, boys? Yes, sir.
Start a grass fire near the north boundary of the place. When Moreland and his wife go to put out the blaze, you'll be able to get to his house without interference.
Well, the boys know what comes after, boys. We loot the place of anything we want, right?
Yes, sir.
Then we set a torch to the building and let them blaze.
Whatever you lay hands on belongs to you.
Mount up, boys!
Tipton! Press Tipton.
Yeah, boss.
I won't ride with you tonight. Meet me tomorrow, the usual place.
Right. Tomorrow, the same place.
Are you men ready?
Yeah.
Then let's ride and loot and burn them out. Yeah.
It is almost the middle of the night. Instead of sleeping or riding along like a couple of local hootie owls. Why we do this, Cisco?
Oh, stop your grumbling, Pancho, and the ride will not seem as long or as hard to you.
All right. Yeah, Pancho, stop grumbling, and the ride not seem no shorter or no easier. Cisco, what we do?
I told you, Pancho, I saw the silhouette of those hombres along the rim of the hill. They're headed in the same direction we are.
That's no reason for us to get up in the middle of the night and break the camp and follow them.
Where there are night riders, there is trouble. They strike in the dark like a pack of cowardly coyotes because they are afraid to do so in the daylight.
Listen, Cisco. One time for all, Pancho tried to tell you. This town is Red Rock, a little town. We not know nobody here. Nobody bother us. Well, we do like you say, ride around the town, mind their own business.
Is that so, Chico?
That's so.
And what do you suggest we do about that?
Well, what? Cisco, there's a grass fire. Hey, those night riders.
What did I tell you?
Geez, you're right. Well, why we wait?
Come on, Pancho, up here.
Go!
Those skulking mavericks.
Hey, they're so busy with the fire, they not see us.
Unholster your guns and send them a message of heartland.
Yes, Cisco. Some of those coyotes mount up and ride away.
No, they are not leaving.
Hey, those night riders setting the fire all along that fence line.
See, it must be the boundary marker for that rancho. Madre mía.
Huh?
Unless the hombres living there are warned, they will be completely burned out.
How can we warn them, Cisco? Those night riding coyotes gun us down if we try to ride past them.
There's a chance worth taking to save a life. There's still a break between the two fires set by those mavericks. I will try to ride through it on Diablo.
Now, can't you go with you, Cisco?
No. Remain here and keep me covered. The wind changes, start a backfire and meet the blaze already going.
All right, Cisco, can't you do it? But you be careful. I do want to see you again. Alive.
You can be sure I will do everything I can to make sure your wish is granted. Adios, Chico. Adios.
Hasta luego, Cisco.
Hey, when'll I catch up to you, stranger?
Get up here.
Si, senor. Take your time now that the fire is out. It'll be daylight before long.
Oh, boy. I sure do appreciate your help in putting out that fire. Say, I don't even know your name.
I am known as the Cisco Kid, senor.
Well, I'm Bud Morland, Cisco. I can never repay you for what you've done. Every stick of wood in the running end would be burned to a crisp if you hadn't helped me.
Why did those night-riding coyotes set fire to your rancho, Senor Bud?
I can't figure it out, Cisco. And I'm not the only one in the dark. Half a dozen ranches around Red Rock have been leveled by fire. No one knows why.
Yeah, two hombres coming this way. They may mean trouble.
Well, they've come to the right place for it.
Keep riding straight ahead, you sidewinder.
Hold your fire, Cisco. That's Claire's voice. Claire, over here. This way.
This is the end of the ride. Pull up your horse, you stalking firebug.
Hold over. Slow down.
Pancho, what happened to you?
Is he a friend of yours?
Si, senora.
Then get them fire-setting hands of yours up in the air. Bud, take his gun.
Now, hold on, Claire. You got your rope around the wrong calf. Who do you think saved our ranch and our lives? This hombre here, the Cisco Kid.
And that hombre there is mi compañero Pancho, Senora Moreland.
But he's got to be one of them sneaking night riders. I caught him setting fire to the grass.
See, that's right. How was Pancho going to start a backfire like Cisco told Pancho to do? Why'd you not listen when Pancho tried to told you?
You mean you... Oh, I'm sorry, Pancho.
That not make Pancho feel better. Right up on Pancho, you take away Pancho's guns. How do you think it looked for a grand caballero to be captured by a senora?
I do apologize, Pancho. I don't know what to say.
Calm now, Pancho. Your feelings are not that badly hurt. Oh,
after all, it was a natural mistake on Claire's part, Pancho.
But Pancho never before had the beautiful senora make the apology to Pancho. Pancho like it.
What has happened here tonight is not funny, amigo. We are going after those night-riding mavericks.
We are?
Deal me in, Cisco. Any way you play your cards, I'll back you.
None of you will do much dealing or backing until you've had some breakfast. And even then, you can bet your bottom dollar the cards will still be stacked against you. Get up!
Diablo, come on!
Go!
And I figured I could get some advice here at the bank from you, Mr. Gordon.
Yes, of course, Mr. Tipton. Come right into my office, and we won't be disturbed there. This way. Well, Chris?
Well, Warren?
Last night, how did it go?
Bad. Very bad.
Well, you burned out the running M.
Nope.
What?
We started to, and...
Well, what stopped you?
A two-gun maniac on a whirlwind of a cayuse. He scattered the boys with a blaze of bullets, and then he rode through a break in the fire like he was a Brahma bull on stampede.
Only one hombre?
No, there was plenty of gunfire covering him. There must have been others. He'd never have the nerve to do it alone.
Well, I'm not giving up on the Moreland place. I need it too much.
But you control all those other ranches now, boy.
I know. And the mother load of that gold vein runs right onto the running M. I've got to have it.
You want me to go out by way of the back door, Warren?
No, it's not necessary, Chris. As far as anyone knows, you're here on legitimate business. Yes? Come in, please.
Oh, I didn't know you were busy, Warren. My friend and I'll come back later.
No, Bud. Mr. Tipton and I are finished with our business.
Senor Tipton and I never finished our business, did we, Senor Tipton?
You two know each other?
No. Not that I recollect.
Santa Fe, 2 years ago. Bunch of wagon train raiders were captured.
I ain't never been in Santa Fe.
I helped round them up.
I told you I ain't never been in Santa Fe.
I saw you, hombre.
You're a liar.
Hombres have died because of that word.
Why, you...
Go ahead, Quetti. Draw. Well?
Gentlemen, please.
No one calls me liar, Tipton. Draw. I will not wait.
No, I take it back.
Man, oh man, I never saw the lack of it. You certainly are a cool one, Cisco. The time for Cress Tipton to meet his match is long overdue. I was sure this office would be shot up.
Then Tipton is not a friend of yours, Senor Banker?
Certainly not. He was in here on business, just like you and Bud are.
I'm here to try to get the loan on the Running M extended. Them night riders came to see us.
You mean the Running M was set on fire?
Well, it would have been burned out if it hadn't been for the Cisco kid here.
My hunch is that Tipton was with those night riders. His kind do not change because they serve a jail sentence.
By thunder, you could be right, Cisco. Tipton and those saddled bums of his might be guilty of all those fires we've had here in Red Rock. And if that's true, Bud, Red Rock needs your friend, the Cisco kid, as marshal.
Gracias, Señor Gordon. I do not need to wear a badge. With your help, I can get Tipton.
You can count on me, Cisco.
Good. By working together, we can rid this town of those outlaws.
That's my plan exactly, Bud. To get rid of everyone who stands in my way of making Red Rock the kind of town I want it to be.
But, Senora Claire, Cisco and Senor Bud tell us to stay here at the rancho until they get back.
I know what they said. And I know what I'm going to do, Pancho.
What you do, huh?
Soon as I finish harnessing the team to the buckboard, I'm going into town. My woman's intuition tells me there's trouble.
Cisco and Senor Bud take care of themselves if there's trouble.
If I'm there, maybe there won't be any gunplay.
Horses and riders coming, lots of them. Madre mía, that woman's institution tells you right. Those hombres all masked.
Night riders.
But this is the daytime. Why the ride now?
Into the house, Pancho.
Pancho, is Cisco here?
Hurry, Pancho, hurry.
Lights and torches. Make ready for the run.
In here. Quickly.
We make it.
Get those rifles. We'll give those yellow dogs a taste of hot lead.
Si, Senora Claire.
Open fire. Pour it on to them.
Keep down, Senora.
Give me that rifle.
Senora! Senora Claire! She got hit by the bullet.
You men with the torches. Burn them out.
Pancho, Pancho, you murdering coyotes, you. Try to burn down the house, huh? And Pancho fights you till Pancho dead.
And in the face of the tremendous odds, how can the outcome result in anything other than Pancho's death? In just a moment, we'll return to The Cisco Kid.
Now you can bring appetizing, satisfying goodness to any diet meal with deliciously different Roman meal bread. You see, this rich and unusual dark bread, baked only by butternut, gives you just 62 calories per slice.
yet it supplies that important touch of real eating enjoyment you need on any diet, with plenty of nutrition, too. Roman Meal's flavor is completely different from any other bread. It's a dark bread, that's right, but it's a dark bread with typical white bread tenderness, the richness of rye, the goodness of whole wheat. It's smooth and lastingly fresh. Roman Meal gives you that delightful combination of white, wheat, and rye flours, blended with honey and prune juice for extra zest. And whether you're on a diet or if you just plain like good food, try Roman Meal. Just look for the bright and attractive wrapper with the Roman Meal Gladiator emblem. Roman Meal bread, baked only by butternut. Fresh at your grocer's every day. Delicious for every meal.
And now back to the Cisco Kid in our gripping story, Night Riders of Red Rock. Bud and Claire Moreland are aided by Cisco and Pancho in a fight against night riders. Unknown to them, Cress Tipton leads the desperados, who are bossed by banker Warren Gordon. A showdown between Cisco and Cress occurs. In retaliation, Cress and his men ride to burn out Bud's ranch. Pancho and Claire are trapped in the ranch house by a hail of gunfire, which is heard by Cisco and Bud as they return from Red Rock.
Cisco, those gunshots are coming from the direction of the ranch house.
Come on, Senor Bud, up here.
Get up.
What is the quickest way home?
Up over the top of that knoll.
Get out, Diablo.
Now we can see the house.
Santos. Un momento, Senor Bud.
Hold. They're making ready to set fire to the ranch. Hey, that runaway buckboard and team are mine. Pancho and Claire must be inside the house. Let's go.
Wait, Senor Bud. It would be suicide. There are too many for us. But I can stop that maverick carrying the lighted torch.
Good, Cisco. You made him turn off his course.
Draw their fire up here, Senor Bud.
Where are you going?
After the runaway team and the buckboard.
What for?
I am going to use the team to get me to the house.
How?
By lying flat on the wagon tongue, I can drive the horses and still not be a target for those renegades.
Well, that's risky business, Cisco. Don't do it. Chances are you won't come through alive.
Chances are the Senor and Pancho may not come through alive if I do not. Open fire, Senor Bud. Keep those puck rats busy. Hasta luego. After you, hurry.
Head feels like the top of the barn fell on it.
Hey, that bullet just grazed the top of your head, Senora Claire. But those coyotes not trying to burn us out no more.
Are you sure, Pancho?
Sure.
I wonder what could have stopped. Pancho!
What?
There's Bud up on top of that knoll. He's drawing their gunfire.
But where's Cisco? Senora Claire, the team I run away is coming back to the house.
Hold your fire! That team in buckboard. There's an hombre on the wagon, Tom. Get him.
Madre mia, that's Cisco.
He's going to drop to the ground when that team passes the house and then make a dash for the door. I'd better get it open.
Yeah, and Pancho cover Cisco when he make the dash.
Ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Hurry, Cisco. Hurry.
The andale. Andale, Pancho. Into the house, Cisco.
Get him.
Pancho, get you back good as you said.
Gracias, amigo. All right, that's enough. You, in the house, save your bullets for the next time. There'll be a next time when you're least expected. Come on, boys, get up.
Oh, you come just at the right time, Cisco. Those night riding mavericks afraid of you, and they turn and run away.
Yeah, they are not afraid of me, Pancho.
Then Bud has other men with him up on that knoll?
No, senora. Those pack rats who came to burn down the buildings may have thought so.
But they know they're not going to do that while Cisco here. Because Cisco's good shooting keeps them and their torches away from the house.
Well, that might be the reason, Pancho.
How would those night riders know whether you're a good shot or not, Cisco?
If my hunch is right, their leader has a good reason to know.
You know him, Cisco?
So do you, Pancho.
Me too, I know him too.
In town, Senor Bud and I met up with that coyote Cress Tipton from Santa Fe. You remember him?
Pancho, remember that dirty, skulking maverick?
I'm almost certain he was the one who called out, "There will be a next time." It will be the last time for him.
He also said it would be when we'd least expect it. Take care, Cisco, that it's not the last time for you.
And due to your stupid hot-headedness, we may lose everything, Chris.
Well, I told you, me and the men were masked, Warren. Will you stop pacing back and forth? Cisco, Bud, and the others couldn't have recognized us.
I will know soon enough. Bud's due here any minute to find out whether or not I'll extend the loan on the running M.
Are you going to?
Of course. I'll even loan him more money.
And then foreclose on his place after we burn him out.
Which you won't do until I tell you. You savvy?
It'll be as you say, Warren.
Being on the inside of the plan Cisco and Bud are making is going to help us plenty.
I'm going to help the Cisco kid to a grave in Boot Hill.
When I tell you, and not before. Beat it. Go on out the back door.
When should I tell the boys to be ready to ride again?
Come back in an hour. I'll let you know. If it's at all possible, I'm going to make it for tonight. Once and for all, we'll clean house of the Morlands, Pancho, and the Cisco Kid.
Well, I don't know, Warren. The terms of this loan are sure different than those of the first one you made me.
Well, after all, Bud, I'm running a bank. The money really belongs to the depositors. I have to safeguard their interests.
In what way are the terms of this loan different, Senor Bud?
The collateral. Look here, Cisco. This loan calls for me to lose the running M to the bank if I don't pay up when called.
A call loan?
Yes, that's right. Just for the sake of the depositors. Because of those blasted night riders. You know I wouldn't call that loan on you, Bud. I'll give you all the time you need to pay it back.
Provided them night riders don't hit me again, huh?
Well, in that case, I'd have no choice, Bud. But with Cisco around, there's no worry.
They are not captured yet, Senor Banker.
We ought to set up a plan to put them behind bars.
Got any ideas how to go about it?
Well, why not call a meeting of all the townsfolk tonight? Over at the schoolhouse.
Well, that sounds sensible enough. Will you preside over the meeting, Senor Gordon?
Of course, of course. I may be a little late. I've some work here at the bank.
There's not much more I can do except sign the loan, I reckon. Can't fix the damage without your money, and if those bushwhacking firebugs try to burn me out again, I won't be able to fix the damage with money. And you might as well have the ranch.
Good enough. I'll deposit this sum to your account. And stop worrying about the night riders. After tonight, they won't do any more riding.
If your business is over, Senor Bud, let us be on our way.
Oh, what about your hunch, Cisco? I mean...
Forget about it, Senor Bud. Come on.
No, wait a minute. What is your hunch, Cisco?
Oh, it was nothing, Senor Banker. Adios.
I'll be seeing you tonight, Warren. Let's use the back door, Cisco. Our horses are just across the street.
Go ahead, help yourself. See you both tonight.
What's the matter, Cisco? Why didn't you want me to tell Warren about Crest Tipton?
Because of what the banker said.
He said lots of things.
A meeting in town tonight will give the night riders a chance to finish what they started at your rancho.
You mean you think Warren and the night riders might be...
An hombre does not suggest a meeting and then decide he has to work late that very night.
Wait a minute. Let's go back and get him.
No, Senor Bud. I think he and the night riders plan to burn the running M tonight. Let him alone, and we will capture every one of those pack rats.
What do you got in mind?
You attend the meeting. I will follow the banker. If I am right, he will try to attack your place.
If he does, I'll be there with every hombre who attends the meeting.
That is exactly what I had in mind. We will make certain the banker's statement comes true. After tonight, the night riders will ride no more. Up there, come on!
This rifle loaded. I still would feel a lot safer, Pancho, if Bud and Cisco were here.
They'd be here just like they say, Senora Claire. Now you worry. Cisco keep his word.
Riders coming.
See what Pancho tells you? It's too dark for Pancho to see who they is.
Better get out of the lighted doorway just in case.
That guy that be saying your Bud and the hombres from the town, or they be shooting at us by now.
Good work. Hang on to the gal, Pancho.
Chris Tipton, you, Coyote Joe. Where'd you come from?
From around the side of the house, fat one.
Fat one, huh?
I had the rest of the boys ride up that way purposely just to draw you two outside. Hey, men, keep your eyes open for Cisco and Bud and them hombres from town. They'll be coming just like the boss said they would. Hey, Slim, you and the boys, get that rider coming this way.
Don't worry about him, Chris. It's the boss, mask and all.
I'm afraid we lost, Pancho. Looks like Cisco wasn't able to do what he said.
Pancho wonder how the bank could get away from Cisco.
So you know about Warren, eh? Well, the knowledge ain't gonna do you much good.
Hey, boss. These two know who you are, and if they do, there ain't no doubt the rest of the town does, too. But...
Into the house with you, Crestington. The light, Pancho. Senora Clara, slam the door.
Here it turns, Cisco. And Pancho thing at first, you that banker.
All right. Up on your feet, Tipton.
I don't know how you got the boss's clothes, but I'm going to knock you out of them.
This is the way I got your boss, the banker's clothes, Maverick. And he ended up, face down, on the floor.
Well, you now got the banker the same way, Cisco?
Hey, get to those windows. Keep those other night-riding skunks away from here with your guns.
Where's Bud and the men from town?
Not far. I turned Gordon over to them before I rode up to the house.
I just showed you, Maverick. Cisco, they're not shooting at us.
No, their bullets are going in the other direction.
Those night riders not want to fight with the hombres from the town. And they give up.
Bud! Bud Moreland, are you all right?
Oh, hold it, hold it. Climb down off that horse, Gordon.
All right, you don't have to yank me.
And the townspeople rounding up those bandidos.
We started after them as soon as we figured you were in the house, Cisco.
But how did you get Gordon's clothes, Cisco?
I have been following him since he left his office, Senora Claire. When he changed to this costume and put on the mask, I had all the evidence I needed.
And Cisco took Gordon's clothes so he could get past the night riders and into the house.
And it looked to Pancho like it worked all right, eh, senor bandido banker?
Let him do his talking at the trial. I am sure he, Tipton, and all the night riders will talk their way into jail. The rotten deeds they have done will speak for them.
Cisco!
Si, Pancho.
Just like you say, all those night riders be in the jail the rest of their lives.
Si. And it's good to know that Senor Bud and Senora Claire will not lose their rancho. And
all the other hombres what burned out get their ranchos back, too.
It's very good news for them to learn that there is a rich vein of gold running under their land.
Yeah, more than pay them back for the damage the fires do.
Oh, si, that is right. And when their homes are fixed, they will live in there many, many years.
Uh-huh. Did you know Pancho's cousin Pedro, he lived in one house for many, many years.
Oh, he did?
Oh, see, for 20 years. Then he moved.
But after 20 years, what made cousin Pedro move?
Oh, the governor pardoned him.
Oh, Pancho!
Oh, Cisco!
And so ends another exciting adventure with O. Henry's famous Robin Hood of the West, the Cisco Kid.
Say, boys and girls, do you like to go to the grocery store with Mother? Does she even let you push the cart around sometimes or carry home the packages? Well, she'd most likely be more than pleased if you'd help her with the shopping, too. And you know you'll always pick up the right bread if you pick up the bread with the picture of the slices right on the wrapper. Yes, sir, just reach out for a loaf of...
Tut, tut, nothing but butternut bread.
And when you do, you'll be the apple of Mom's eye, and Dad's too. Because man, woman, boy or girl, everybody goes for good butternut bread. That tantalizing aroma of fresh-baked bread, that tender freshness, that full-flavored richness, they're all qualities of the finest bread, butternut bread. And what's more, butternut helps provide you with the essentials you need to keep going strong all day long. So next time you go to the store with Mother, pick up the bread in the blue and white check gingham wrapper, the wrapper with a picture of fresh white slices right on it. Good butternut bread.
Be sure to listen again for another thrilling adventure of the Cisco Kid. Cisco Kid was played by Jack Mather, Poncho by Harry Lang.
Hello there. This is CBS Radio Mystery Theater's Gordon Gould. You are listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
We're back with you, folks. Hope you enjoyed the Cisco Kid there. That was the Knight Riders of Red Rock.
See.
From the mid-1950s. Sigh.
I like show.
Mutual Don Lee and in syndication. Yes, indeed. Now, are we going to start that C and Psy routine that Jack and Mel Blanc used to do?
See.
You have a sister?
Bye.
No, it's C.
C.
And her name?
Señorita.
All right. Greg's not cooperating with the routine here, so this will probably just get edited out anyway, since he's not cooperating with it.
That's right. I'm a rebel.
So your name? Psy. Psy. C. You have a sister? C. Her name? Sue. Sue. C. You know, that's how it goes.
C.
Yeah. That's how it goes. Anyway, we are out of time. Welcome to the bad recreation hour here on The Glowing Dial. Now we're going to do Who's On First. No, we're not. Because I don't know the whole routine. Although I do remember a time when Lou Costello said, "I don't give a damn," instead of "I don't give a darn." It was an armed forces film, which occasionally were shown in theaters, showing how the radio shows were done. They were doing a mail call, strictly GI show. Abbott and Costello were the guests. They were doing their Who's On First. And it's cool because you see Bud's reaction when Lou says, "I don't give a damn." Which I guess they thought they could get away with in the theater. Or maybe they, I don't know, maybe, I don't even know if the films were shown in
the servicemen, they wanted something
theaters.
A little more oomph.
Exactly. They weren't shown in domestic theaters, I don't think. Unless it was to give the home viewers a little view of what a radio show looked like for those of you who did not live in New York or L.A. where these shows were done. And to be in the audience of a Jack Benny program, now would that have been something?
Mm-hmm.
That's another thing I'd do with my time machine. Go to the Jack Benny episodes, the one where Frank Nelson says, "Who do you think I am, Dreer Poussin?" It's the one where Jack broke up. The writers pulled Frank aside and said, "Here, ad-lib this line." He said, "You don't ad-lib with Jack Benny." "Yes, we'll take responsibility." He did, and it was gold. Jack fell down, pounded the floor, went to the back curtain, slid down it, pounded the floor again, then got himself back to the mic. That was, they say your money or your life was the longest laugh. It was not. That was one. Right there. Anyway, I think we'll do another Jack Benny tribute. Maybe we'll do a birthday tribute to him next Valentine's Day. What do you think?
Cool.
Awesome. It's got to be, yeah, one of them has got to feature Frank Nelson, at least. And Mel Blanc. And Betty Rubble, who was one of the telephone operators. Gertrude Gearshift and Mabel Flapsaddle. Mr. Benny's line is flashing. Folks, we are out of time. And the
you
ghost
might even
of
be overtime.
It's closing time is what it is. Greg, thank you, sir, for being with us here the past three episodes, actually. You've put in your due, and
when do I get paid?
You put in your dippity-do, whatever.
Ew.
You get paid as soon as we're done with this show.
Yay!
I'm going to pay you twice what you're worth.
Oh.
So you're going to walk home broke. But anyway, thanks, really, for being here. And folks, stay with us, because Stu is going to be back for a couple of shows.
Show off.
And I can't tell you what's next, because I don't have the paper in front of me. But it's going to be something cool. So. It'll
it's
be something literally cool, because we'll be into October at that point. Yes.
How disappointing.
I don't look forward to all the leaves falling.
Me neither.
No.
I hate raking.
I look forward to the cooler temperatures because it's better sleeping at night. The sheets don't stick to me.
No.
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 You love sheets sticking to you.
I don't have that problem.
Having the bed wet.
I don't have that problem. I don't wet the
bed. With sweat, that is, not with pee. Not with pee.
He said the P word.
I haven't done that since I was 11, but anyway.
That's very significant.
Yes, it is. I had that disorder when I was 11, and it was embarrassing as hell. But you didn't want to hear my urine history here.
It leaked out.
It just leaked out like Watergate. We had a leak. All right, that didn't work at all. I was going to say Frank Nelson and his band are standing by. It is definitely time to say goodbye, folks. Paul Whiteman, or the ghost of Paul Whiteman and his orchestra, are behind us here, right at the microphone, and they are ready.
Playing the tune Spooky.
I got nothing. Anyway, hit it, Paul. Thank you. Folks, we have a few reminders before we get on out of here. Don't forget that Chicken Man set. You know you want one. You know you have to have one. Just look for those silly dancing chickens with the sound effects by Greg on our homepage.
Chicken!
Yeah. Glowing Dial online store is a great place, folks. It has a lot of gift ideas with the Glowing Dial logo and more being designed as we speak. The Glowing Dial bookstore, through our association with Amazon.com, is a great place to do all your Amazon.com shopping. Just click through our store, or look through our store, and then click through to Amazon and do all your shopping there. That helps us out here at the Glowing Dial. Don't forget to join our blog discussion list and Facebook page and get all the latest Glowing Dial news. Celebrity birthdays, well, if you didn't get enough, there's only so much we can do in a three-week period. My buddy Ron Sales has got you covered. He has a blog with the whole year's worth of celebrity birthdays, so you can see who you share your birthday with. So you just go to glowingdial.com, click on links, and there is the link to Ron's blog. Jerry Handigas is a fellow that helps us out in a lot of ways here on the Glowing Dial, carries our show as well, but he has an audio restoration service we want to let you know about, and clean up those old Altium radio recordings, even the big 16-inch transcription disc if you have them. Get in contact with Jerry, you can do that. The link is on our links page, glowingdial.com. Jerry also has his Old Time Radio Network, which is a great place to hear the Glowing Dial and many other radio shows, including his own show that he hosts, in streaming audio. The Glowing Dial page, then, is the internet home of the Glowing Dial, always has been since late 1996 when we started doing the show for YUSA. Links for everything we just mentioned and more there. Plus, you can hear the latest episode of the Glowing Dial right off our page. A great big thank you once again to Jerry Handigas for his programming assistance in this and many other episodes of The Glowing Dial. Also want to tip of the microphone windscreen goes to John over at otrcat.com. He's was good enough to let us use some of his write-ups information on various shows. And our Gunsmoke information came from his website by his permission. So if you want some good old-time radio shows on MP3, head over to otrcat.com. And tell him Big John sent you from the Glowing Dial. Well, you know, that's about it. So, Greg, thank you once again.
You got it.
And as Big John and Greg saying, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, think big, and we will see you on the radio. Bye-bye.